Indian Institute of Technology Delhi, also called IIT Delhi, embodies the best of higher educational ecosystem in the country. IIT Delhi is a confluence of minds, aspirations, and innovations, and is leading the way for technological advancements in the country. IIT Delhi is a 320-acre residential and fully networked campus. Recognized globally as a top-ranked institute, IIT Delhi's success can be attributed to its brilliant students, faculty scientists, R&D programs, and industry collaborations.
Originally, when IITs were established, these were mainly like undergraduate institutions. Same is true with IIT Delhi. We took pride in the quality of undergrads that we produce, but over a period of time, the character of these institutions got changed. Now we are recognized for our research contributions. We are recognized for contributions to the society in terms of the technology development. And IIT Delhi, for example, takes pride in being a top-ranked institution in the country.
Excellence at IIT Delhi is inspirational for the young minds. And the academic attainments of the faculty are evidenced by their numerous awards and accolades. The admission to various academic programs at IIT Delhi is through highly competitive national level exams. IIT Delhi has numerous student exchange programs with several top-ranked global universities. In pursuit of academic excellence, IIT Delhi lays strong emphasis on cutting-edge and interdisciplinary research.
IIT is a great place to be in if you want to do research. We have a research environment which is buzzing with activity day in and day out. We have labs that work 24 hours. Students working actively through the day and through the night in these labs. You would be surprised to know that we have more postgraduate students than undergraduate students here at IIT, that faculty spend almost three quarters of their time doing research and supervising PhD students.
The faculty of IIT Delhi is involved in both open-ended research and goal-oriented focus research. We work closely with the industry and defense departments, space departments, and other organizations. We bring problems from these organizations, and jointly with our students, we try to solve them. And also, in some cases, we develop prototypes. And when the complete technology is developed, we actually hand it over back to the organization for production.
When partners join hands, vision turns into reality. IIT Delhi has a number of national and international collaborations with industry and research organizations. Towards institutionalizing technology commercialization, IIT Delhi pioneered the establishment of Foundation for Innovation and Technology Transfer as an industry interface body in 1992. In 1994, it adopted its intellectual property policy, the earliest by an academic institute in India. IIT Delhi has a strong IP and licensing portfolio. The institute recognized the importance of techno-entrepreneurship early on. The creation of a technology business incubation facility in 2000 gave a huge boost to the startup ecosystem on the campus. The bright students at IIT Delhi continue to leave strong footprints with their ideas and efforts. Be it academics, sports, or social service, IIT Delhi students take the center stage.
Here in IIT Delhi, everybody is working on projects which is just helping the society come forward. Somewhere here on a crutcher, somebody there working on smart cane. It just tells you, it gives you, motivates you that even you have to do something, big or small.
Here you not only get to study things, you understand things, but here you get to know many more things instead of just studies. Like you get a great experience with the industrial people also.
Success breeds success, and the Institute lays claim to several magnificent accomplishments. Illustrious alumni significantly contribute to the global image of IIT Delhi. And many of the alumni occupy leadership positions in various walks of life. Expansion, excellence, and inclusion form the core of IIT Delhi's Vision 2025. It articulates impactful research, quality education, and innovation programs. The quest for excellence at IIT Delhi continues.
The launch here today should act as a catalyst for numerous such initiatives across the country. Throughout history, our educational institutes have been the beacons of our culture.
And for the first time, we are trying to set up an endowment fund in an Indian university in the lines of top US universities.
पहले बार ऐसा अवसर हो रहा है तो सब लोग एक संग्रहित राशि एकजुट करके एक स्थान पर देंगे और फिर वो उसका संचालन करेंगे.
Hopefully it will help us create opportunities and help women become technology leaders across the globe.
I am quite convinced that with the effort of the government and individual citizen, we will overcome this problem. Endowments allow institutions to deliver greater value and attain higher levels of quality.
I would like to thank our Honorable President Shri Ramnath Kovind for supporting this initiative in building history for the Indian education system.
Jab pankh mile aur dekha aasmaan mein, na koi khabar thi hoga kya udaan mein. Tune saans bhari, आगे बढ़ा, उस डर के परे तू फिर भी उड़ा.
By giving through endowments, you are not just giving to your institution, but you are also supporting and nurturing future generations of learners. Endowments enables institutions to take greater risks in undertaking innovative projects, developing stronger teaching programs, and enhancing fiscal infrastructure.
We are establishing a giving back culture in this country through this initiative.
No university in the world has ever achieved eminence without strong alumni involvement or a substantial endowment fund.
We feel it's time now for us to give back. Din har koi aur hai, devat hai din rain, log bharam mopu karein, tate niche nain.
We are transitioning from multi-generational giving to first-generational giving.
This is an example for a country and an institution in this country. I move across the world and I assure everybody that we do need it very much in our country.
I truly believe that the endowment fund will be a trendsetter.
Like for years I've been giving money to all the colleges in the US where I studied. There's no real way to contribute here. And now I'm so happy that now we have a fund, we can actually contribute to the fund. We now feel that there is something that we can leave for the next generation.
Ab nazar na hata, aane wala maqam hai. Waqt ki kalam ko to likhna tera hi naam hai.
I would like you to find ways to give back to your institution and society in whatever way you can. The cause does not matter, only your will to make a difference.
Tumne ban aankhon se dekhe the khwab jo hai zubaan bina tere dil ko phir bhi hai yaad wo. तूने बन आंखों से देखे थे ख्वाब जो है जुबां बिना तेरे दिल को फिर भी है याद वो. आँखों से देखे थे ख्वाब जो है जुबान बिना तेरे दिल को फिर भी है याद वो. है रास्ता तुझको पता अब ढूंढ ले मंजिल के निशान. खुद बना ले जिंदगी मत समझ ये भाग है ना खत्म. जो हुई वो तेरे अंदर की आग है. आग है आग है आग है आग है. जब पंख मिले और देखा आसमान में ना कोई खबर थी होगा क्या उड़ान में. तूने सांस भरी तू आगे बढ़ा उस डर के परे तू फिर भी उड़ा. अब नजर ना हटा आने वाला मकाम है. वक्त की कलम को तो लिखना तेरा ही नाम है. नाम है नाम है नाम है नाम है. वो मिल जाएगा जिसका इंतजार था. दिल जिसके लिए यूं तेरा बेकरार था.
सब मुश्किलें तुझे छोड़ कर छुप जाएंगी उस मोड़ पर। और कर कद्दू बया जो तेरी अपनी किताब है, ये जहां दोहराएगा जो सिर्फ तेरा ही ख्वाब है। ख्वाब है, ख्वाब है, ख्वाब है, ख्वाब है। हो
Indian Institute of Technology Delhi, also called IIT Delhi, embodies the best of higher educational ecosystem in the country. IIT Delhi is a confluence of minds, aspirations, and innovations, and is leading the way for technological advancements in the country. IIT Delhi is a 320-acre residential and fully networked campus. Recognized globally as a top-ranked institute, IIT Delhi's success can be attributed to its brilliant students, faculty scientists, R&D programs, and industry collaborations.
Originally, when IITs were established, these were mainly like undergraduate institutions. Same is true with IIT Delhi. We took pride in the quality of undergrads that we produce, but over a period of time the character of these institutions got changed. Now we are recognized for our research contributions. We are recognized for contributions to the society in terms of the technology development, and IIT Delhi, for example, takes pride in being a top ranked institution in the country.
Excellence at IIT Delhi is inspirational for the young minds, and the academic attainments of the faculty are evidenced by their numerous awards and accolades. The admission to various academic programs at IIT Delhi is through highly competitive national level exams. IIT Delhi has numerous student exchange programs with several top-ranked global universities. In pursuit of academic excellence, IIT Delhi lays strong emphasis on cutting-edge and interdisciplinary research.
IIT is a great place to be in if you want to do research. We have a research environment which is buzzing with activity day in and day out. We have labs that work 24 hours. Students working actively through the day and through the night in these labs. You would be surprised to know that we have more postgraduate students than undergraduate students here at IIT, that faculty spend almost three quarters of their time doing research and supervising PhD students.
The faculty of IIT Delhi is involved in both open-ended research and goal-oriented focus research. We work closely with the industry and defense departments, space departments and other organizations. We bring problems from these organizations and jointly with our students, we try to solve them, and also in some cases we develop prototypes, and when the complete technology is developed, we actually hand it over back to the organization for production.
When partners join hands, vision turns into reality. IIT Delhi has a number of national and international collaborations with industry and research organizations. Towards institutionalizing technology commercialization, IIT Delhi pioneered the establishment of Foundation for Innovation and Technology Transfer as an industry interface body in 1992. In 1994, it adopted its intellectual property policy, the earliest by an academic institute in India. IIT Delhi has a strong IP and licensing portfolio. The institute recognized the importance of techno-entrepreneurship early on. The creation of a technology business incubation facility in 2000 gave a huge boost to the startup ecosystem on the campus. The bright students at IIT Delhi continue to leave strong footprints with their ideas and efforts. Be it academics, sports, or social service, IIT Delhi students take the center stage.
Here in IIT Delhi, everybody is working on projects which is just helping the society come forward. Somewhere here on a crutcher, somebody there working on smart cane, it just tells you, it gives you, motivates you that even you have to do something, big or small.
Here you not only get to study things, you understand things, but here you get to know many more things instead of just studies. Like you get a great experience with the industrial people also.
Success breeds success, and the institute lays claim to several magnificent accomplishments.
Sir, good morning from all of us here, sir. Sir, good morning from all of us here, IIT Delhi.
Good morning. राम गोपाल जी और आपकी पूरी टीम को शुभकामना.
थैंक यू वेरी मच.
धन्यवाद.
धन्यवाद सर.
क्या साहा जी भी जुड़े हैं?
हाँ, साहा जी भी जुड़े हैं. साहा जी
सुबीर जी.
यस.
राम गोपाल जी, अभी तक टोटल कितने निदेशक रहे हैं इन 60 वर्षों में?
दे रहे.
13 सर, टोटल 13 सो फार.
13. 13.
अच्छा 13.
गुड मॉर्निंग. Good morning. I would like to welcome all of you, Honorable Vice President, Honorable HRD Minister, and all my colleagues here. We have Professor S.K. Saha, Professor Vivek Bua, who are organizing committee chairs and co-chairs. We have our two deputy directors. And we have Professor Bala, and we have Professor Richa Kumar. I request her to take over and compare the program. Sir Richa Kumar.
Thank you, Professor Rao. Suprabhat. Good morning, everyone. आज के IIT दिल्ली के डायमंड जुबली उद्घाटन समारोह में आप सभी का हार्दिक स्वागत है. I extend a warm welcome to everybody on this historic day today. इस ऐतिहासिक साल के उद्घाटन कार्यक्रम के अवसर पर हमारे मुख्य अतिथि माननीय उपराष्ट्रपति श्री एम वेंकैया नायडू ने हमारे निमंत्रण को स्वीकार करके आज के समारोह की मर्यादा बढ़ाई है और हम उनके आभारी हैं. आज के समारोह के विशिष्ट अतिथि माननीय श्री रमेश पोखरियाल निशांक मानव संसाधन विकास मंत्री ने भी अपनी उपस्थिति से हमारा मान बढ़ाया है। आज यहाँ IIT दिल्ली के डायरेक्टर प्रोफेसर राम गोपाल राव के साथ सत्य भारती इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ टेक्नोलॉजी के वाइस चांसलर प्रोफेसर एम बालकृष्णन है हमारे साथ, IIT दिल्ली के डेप्यूटी डायरेक्टर स्ट्रेटजी एंड प्लानिंग प्रोफेसर AK गांगुली, डेप्यूटी डायरेक्टर ऑपरेशंस प्रोफेसर TC कानपाल, डायमंड जुबली कमेटी के चेयरपर्सन प्रोफेसर SK साहा और वाइस चेयरपर्सन प्रोफेसर विवेक बुआ, ये सब भी वर्चुअल उद्घाटन समारोह में सम्मिलित हैं हमारे साथ। हम माननीय मुख्य अतिथि, माननीय विशिष्ट अतिथि, IIT दिल्ली के डायरेक्टर, सभी डिग्निटरीज और अतिथि गणों को तहे दिल से स्वागत करते हैं। अब मैं IIT दिल्ली के डायरेक्टर प्रोफेसर राम गोपाल राव को वेलकम स्पीच देने के लिए आमंत्रित करती हूँ, पर उससे पहले मैं उनके बारे में दो शब्द कहना चाहूंगी। प्रोफेसर राम गोपाल राव नैनो इलेक्ट्रॉनिक्स के क्षेत्र में देश के प्रमुख वैज्ञानिकों में से हैं। उन्होंने 450 से ज्यादा रिसर्च पेपर्स पब्लिश किए हैं और 44 पेटेंट रजिस्टर करवाए हैं, जिसमें से 15 USA से इशू किए गए हैं। प्रोफेसर राव एक एंटरप्रेन्योर भी हैं और डीप टेक्नोलॉजी से रिलेटेड 2 स्टार्टअप्स शुरू करने का श्रेय उनको जाता है। वे शांति स्वरूप भटनागर पुरस्कार और इंफोसिस प्राइज से भी सम्मानित किए गए हैं और भी कई पुरस्कारों के साथ। प्रोफेसर राव प्लीज।
थैंक यू वेरी मच प्रोफेसर ऋचा कुमार, ऑनरेबल वाइस प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ इंडिया श्री वेंकैया नायडू जी, ऑनरेबल एंड अवर ओन मिनिस्टर फॉर HRD डॉक्टर रमेश निशांक पोखरियाल जी, मेंबर्स ऑफ द बोर्ड ऑफ गवर्नर्स, फैकल्टी, स्टाफ, स्टूडेंट्स, अलमनाई, गेस्ट एंड वेल विशर्स ऑफ IIT दिल्ली फ्रॉम ऑल ओवर द वर्ल्ड। Diamond Jubilee is indeed a milestone for any institution, and we wish to thank Honorable Vice President of India and Honorable HRD Minister for inaugurating the year-long Diamond Jubilee celebrations today. 5 older IITs were created during 1951, that was IIT Kharagpur, to 1961, that is IIT Delhi, as modern temples of learning after independence. IIT Delhi, being the youngest of the older 5 IITs, also had the characteristics which are usually ascribed to the youngest child in the family: highly social, energetic, confident, creative, and good at problem solving. IIT Delhi, starting with the founding director, Professor R.N. Dogra, who literally laid the foundation for what is to be called IIT, imbibed and nurtured all of these qualities that made IIT Delhi to become a center of excellence for education, research, and innovation. The 5 older IITs followed initially a similar trajectory, with each one of these IITs being mentored by a specific country. IIT Delhi had UK as the founding partner. IITs were set up as undergraduate-centric institutions. They soon became the finest institutions in the world for undergraduate education. These institutions devised their own examinations, until today the only thing needed to enter IITs is clearing one single examination. No other questions are asked after that. Many of the early batches of students also left the shores of the country for want of better career opportunities. Most of them specifically immigrated to the US and built brand IIT and brand India in the US. Since 1990s, IIT started to focus more and more on research, and at IIT Delhi, we now have more postgraduate students than the undergraduate students. In the QS World Rankings, specifically for research impact, IIT Delhi has consistently been ranked among the top 100 institutions in the world for the citations per faculty data. For engineering, in the subject ranking engineering, IIT Delhi is ranked 47th in the world in 2020 by QS. IIT Delhi also produced pioneers and educators in different subjects, such as Professor M.S. Soda, Professor K.L. Chopra, Professor S.K. Guha, Professor Ghatak, Professor P.V. Indiresan, among many other stalwarts. The tradition of research excellence still continues at IIT Delhi. Something else also changed in the last decade. many IIT Delhi students started to stay back in the country and contribute directly to the national growth. In the last 5 years, for example, less than 5% of IIT Delhi students have opted for careers abroad. 95% of IIT Delhi graduates are now deciding to stay back in the country and contribute to the national growth. Thanks to our alumni, IIT Delhi has become a world leader and ranked number one in India and among the top 10 institutions in the world for its entrepreneurship activities. This rank is specifically for producing unicorn founders. IIT Delhi graduates have built 12 unicorns valued over $1 billion in India and 3 abroad. 12 unicorns in India and 3 abroad. To put things in perspective, IIT Delhi alumni created half of all the unicorns founded by Indians until now. These IIT Delhi startups have also raised close to $20 billion private equity investments in the last 2 decades. In the last 5 years alone, IIT Delhi faculty and students have written over 10,000 high quality papers. In the last 5 years, they have filed over 500 patents and they have executed over 350 industry projects and obtained over 1400 crores of research funding from competitive research grants from all over the world. This is the data specifically for the past 5 years alone. During the COVID times, IIT Delhi gave many technologies to the country and the world for prevention, over 4 million high quality PPEs in the last 3 months, detection, world's most affordable RT-PCR test, and treatment, scientifically validating the effectiveness of Indian traditional medicines such as Ashwagandha for fighting COVID. IIT Delhi is among the first 3 institutions recognized by Government of India as an institution of eminence in 2018 after an elaborate screening process. Whether it is exposing Indian students in schools and colleges to India's rich cultural heritage, Spik Mackay, for example, was founded in 1977 at IIT Delhi by Professor Kiran Seth, or connecting high technology to rural development. For example, the recently launched UBA program of Government of India, MHRD, coming out of IIT Delhi through the Center for Rural Development and Technologies established in 1979, or establishing the tradition of Indians leading large multinational companies in the US, which started with an IIT Delhi alumnus leading McKinsey in 1990s, or creating the startup culture in India. The Foundation for Innovation and Technology Transfer, FITT, created at IIT Delhi way back in 1992, or Sachin and Binny Bansal's founding Flipkart in 2000s. Creation of an endowment fund in Indian institutions, the $1 billion fund launched by Honorable President of India in the presence of HRD Minister in 2019, are achieving gender balance in IITs. IIT Delhi has currently 20% girls in UG classes and 1/3 overall. IIT Delhi has always led from the front. IIT Delhi is always striving to excel and always responding to the national needs and the changes taking place on the technological front. In the last 3 years alone, IIT Delhi has created 7 new degree granting academic entities, 11 new centers of excellence in various thematic areas. On behalf of IIT Delhi community, I assure you, IIT Delhi shall always remain the source of pride for all Indians and shall strive to touch 1 billion lives through its technologies as part of its broad strategy. Honorable Vice President of India is also releasing our vision and strategy document for 2030. I am thankful to McKinsey for putting this together after extensive consultations with various IIT Delhi stakeholders. I would like to finally thank each and every one of you for gracing this event. I would like to thank MHRD for all its help extended to IIT Delhi in all possible ways. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Rao. अब मैं आज के विशिष्ट अतिथि माननीय श्री रमेश पोखरियाल निशांक, मानव संसाधन विकास मंत्री के बारे में 2 शब्द कहना चाहूंगी। श्री पोखरियाल हरिद्वार से सांसद हैं और 2019 में उनको मानव संसाधन विकास मंत्रालय की जिम्मेदारी दी गई। साथ ही वे कवि, लेखक और विचारक भी हैं। उन्होंने 75 से ज्यादा पुस्तकें लिखी हैं। और उनकी पुस्तकों का अध्ययन और विश्लेषण कई स्कॉलर्स ने किया है। उनकी पुस्तकों का अनुवाद कई भारतीय और विदेशी भाषाओं में भी हो चुका है। वे हिमालय और गंगा से जुड़े संवेदनशील मुद्दों को संसद में पुरजोर उठाते रहे हैं। उन्होंने स्पर्श गंगा अभियान का नेतृत्व किया, जिससे क्लीन गंगा के कार्य में पब्लिक पार्टिसिपेशन की अहम भूमिका बनी। माननीय मानव संसाधन विकास मंत्री से हमारा निवेदन है कि वे कृपया हमें संबोधित करें।
आज के इस ऐतिहासिक अवसर पर, जबकि आईआईटी दिल्ली डायमंड जुबली समारोह मना रहे हैं, हमारे बीच भारत के यशस्वी उपराष्ट्रपति, हमारे मार्गदर्शक परम श्रद्धेय वेंकैया जी नायडू उपस्थित हैं। हम सर बहुत हृदय की गहराइयों से आपका अभिनंदन कर रहे हैं कि आपने हमेशा और हमेशा हमारे उच्च संस्थानों को समय देकर के हमको प्रेरित किया है। जब भी हमने आपको याद किया, तब भी आपने शिक्षा के क्षेत्र में जो उत्कृष्ट श्रेणी के हमारे संस्थान है, आपका मार्गदर्शन और आशीर्वाद हमको हमेशा मिलता रहा है। आज के इस महत्वपूर्ण कार्यक्रम में एसके शाह जी जो अध्यक्ष भी हैं डायमंड जुबली कमेटी के, और उनके जो सहायक हैं यहाँ पर, और यहाँ पर सभी उपस्थित अतिथिगण जो हमारे निदेशक राव साहब के साथ बैठे हुए हैं, उनका भी मैं अभिनंदन कर रहा हूँ। इस संस्था के जो आज 60 वर्ष की अपनी महत्वपूर्ण यात्रा करते हुए आज एक संस्थान से एक ब्रांड के रूप में जो स्थापित हो गया है ये आईआईटी, इसका जो मार्गदर्शन कर रहे हैं, इसके केंद्र की धुरी में बहुत ही महत्वपूर्ण भूमिका निभाने वाले इस संस्थान के यशस्वी निदेशक प्रोफेसर वी राम गोपाल राव जी, जिन्होंने एक से एक बहुत पीछे के समय से मैं देख रहा हूं कि लगातार और लगातार एक के बाद एक अभिनव प्रयोग किए हैं। यहां पर उपस्थित सभी संकाय के अध्यक्षगण, स्कूलों के प्रभारीगण, सभी अध्यापकगण, शोध छात्र और सभी उपस्थित भाई और बहनों, मैं समझता हूं कि आज हमारे लिए ये एक सुखद क्षण है, देश के लिए और देश की शिक्षा के लिए, देश के विजन के लिए, देश के मिशन के लिए, देश के नवाचार के लिए, देश के शोध और अनुसंधान के लिए, देश की प्रौद्योगिकी के लिए। और महामहिम जब हम इस संस्थान के बारे में जब सोचते हैं, तो मुझे लगता है कि इसकी 60 वर्ष की यात्रा कोई सामान्य यात्रा नहीं थी। तमाम पड़ावों से होते हुए आज ये 60 वर्ष इसने ज्ञान विज्ञान अनुसंधान और मैनेजमेंट के क्षेत्र में देश को नहीं, पूरी दुनिया को तमाम प्रकार की प्रतिभाओं को दिया है। ये मेरे समस्त आईआईटी में यदि देखेंगे तो ये अलग प्रकार से प्रतिभाओं को उभारा है, विभिन्न प्रकार की प्रतिभाओं को, चाहे वो सुंदर पिचाई हो, सचिन बंसल हो, विनोद हो, पद्मश्री भायर हो, योगेश जी हो, रघुराम जी हो, किरण बेदी हो, चेतन भगत, कहीं लेखक कहीं तो कहीं, और कहीं नारायण मूर्ति जी जैसे लोग हैं, कहीं अरोरा मनोहर पारिक जैसे व्यक्ति हैं, नंदन नीले के नहीं जयंत से। मैं समझता हूं कि इसने प्रशासक से लेकर के लेखक से लेकर के ज्ञान और विज्ञान विविध क्षेत्रों में, ये नहीं कहा जा सकता कि केवल तकनीकी के क्षेत्र में ऐसे नेतृत्व तो ऐसे लोगों को खड़ा किया, यदि देखेंगे तो विविध क्षेत्रों में मेरे आईआईटी और विशेष करके जब हम दिल्ली की बात करते हैं तो दिल्ली के पूर्व छात्रों की एक सूची पर नजर डालते हैं तो हमारा माथा ऊंचा होता है गर्व से। आज केवल वैज्ञानिक और शोध प्रशासक ही नहीं, बल्कि विभिन्न क्षेत्रों में परचम लहराया हमारे संस्था ने। महामहिम जो आईआईटी दिल्ली है, हमारे डायरेक्टर ने जिस तरीके से संक्षिप्त में इसकी प्रगति आख्या समक्ष रखी है, चाहे वो एनआरएफ में शीर्ष स्थान को प्राप्त करने का रहा हो, चाहे क्यूएस रैंकिंग में अपने को बनाए रखने की चुनौती हो। अभी कुछ ही समय पहले देश के एक प्रतिष्ठित पत्रिका ने एक सर्वे किया था, उसके रैंकिंग में 2019 और 20 में मेरे आईआईटी दिल्ली को शीर्षतम नंबर एक स्थान पर रखा। भारत सरकार द्वारा NMICPS के अंतर्गत जो विशेष 7 संस्थान है, उन सर्वश्रेष्ठ 7 संस्थानों में मेरा आईआईटी दिल्ली उसमें शुमार है। और जैसे कि अभी राम गोपाल जी ने कहा कि 10,000 से भी अधिक शोध और 500 से भी अधिक पेटेंट करने वाला ये संस्थान अपने आप में एक बहुत बड़ी गौरवशाली बनकर के नए नए अनुसंधान, नए नए, अभी मैं देख रहा था कि नए पाठ्यक्रम शुरू किए, नए स्कूल, नए सेंटर्स विभिन्न प्रकार के शुरू किए हैं और 54% से भी अधिक यहाँ छात्र जो परास्नातक और पीएचडी के छात्र हैं, 3000 से भी अधिक पीएचडी के सिरमन यहाँ पर रजिस्ट्रेशन है। और मुझे लगता है कि ये भी हमारे लिए गौरव का है, जब हम पूर्व छात्रों की बात करते हैं तो भारतीयों के द्वारा बनाए गए 30 यूनिकॉर्न में से केवल अकेले 15 इस आईआईटी दिल्ली के हैं, जो इस बात को साबित करता है कि आईआईटी दिल्ली अपने विजन और मिशन को लेकर के शिखर को चूम रहा है। आईआईटी दिल्ली के जो पूर्व छात्रों द्वारा 30 मिलियन से अधिक नौकरियों का सृजन किया है, जबकि निवेश में 19 मिलियन अमेरिकी डॉलर जुटाने में महामहिम ये सफल रहा है। पीछे के समय हमने पूर्व छात्रों को लेकर के राष्ट्रपति जी के सानिध्य में एक कमेटी भी बनाई थी और कमेटी बना करके उन्होंने बहुत बड़ी धनराशि ही नहीं दी बल्कि उसको आगे राम गोपाल जी के निर्देशन में, उनके मार्गदर्शन में वो पूर्व छात्र क्या क्या कर सकते हैं, नयापन ला सकते हैं, उनका भी हम लगातार सहयोग ले रहे हैं। महामहिम मैं समझता हूं कि क्योंकि किसी भी संस्था को देखेंगे तो उसका वरिष्ठता, उसकी शिखरता, उसकी श्रेष्ठता, उसकी गुणवत्ता वो उसके पूर्व छात्र पर निर्भर करती है कि उसको निकलने वाला जो छात्र है वो आज दुनिया में किन स्थानों पर है। और जैसे अभी मैंने बताया कि बहुत बहुत क्षेत्रों में आज हमारे ये नेतृत्व कर रहे हैं, जैसे अभी COVID-19 के दौरान जब हमारे देश के प्रधानमंत्री जी ने कहा था कि ये ऐसे संकट के समय मैं आह्वान करता हूं कि आगे आकर के मेरे नौजवान क्या नया कर सकते हैं, इस चुनौती का क्या मुकाबला कर सकते हैं, तो मुझे इस बात की भी खुशी है कि कोविड के दौरान जिस तरीके से लीडरशिप अपने हाथ में लेकर के आईआईटी दिल्ली ने काम किया है और अभी बताया कि कोविड के ही दौरान इस राष्ट्रीय चुनौती का मुकाबला करते हुए भारत और दुनिया को 40 लाख से भी अधिक पीपीई की आपूर्ति की। और इससे भी ज्यादा बड़ी बात महामहिम ये थी कि दुनिया में सबसे सस्ती RT-PCR किट प्रदान की, जो कम समय में, सस्ते में और बहुत गुणवत्तापूर्ण जो है जांचों को करने में सफल रही है। शोध के क्षेत्र में जैसे कि अभी कहा कि जो हमारे आपकी भी हमेशा चिंता रही है कि हमारे अतीत हमारा गौरवशाली रहा है जिसने पूरी दुनिया में हिंदुस्तान को विश्व गुरु के रूप में स्थापित किया, उस अतीत को वर्तमान से जोड़कर और नवाचार के रूप में पूरी विश्व की प्रतिस्पर्धा पर आगे लाने का जो आपका भी सपना है, मेरे देश के प्रधानमंत्री का सपना है, ये आईआईटी दिल्ली अश्वगंधा जैसे जो भारतीय ज्ञान परंपरा की एक बहुत महत्वपूर्ण कड़ी है उसको अभी शोध करके साबित किया है कि इसमें कितनी ताकत है। तो मैं ये समझता हूँ श्रीमन कि हम लगातार और लगातार इन संस्थानों के माध्यम से कुछ देने की ललक को लेकर के आगे बढ़ रहे हैं और समाज में जो हम लोगों का हमेशा कुछ न कुछ देना, हमने वसुधैव कुटुंबकम की बात की है और उस वसुधैव कुटुंबकम को कैसे करके पूरी संसार के अपने परिवार को सशक्त और सबल बनाया जा सकता है, इस दिशा में आईआईटी की बहुत बड़ी भूमिका मुझे लगती है। महामहिम मैं समझता हूं कि आईआईटी एक उत्तम शिक्षा का प्रतीक तो माना जाता है, लेकिन जैसे मैंने कहा केवल शिक्षा नहीं, अब ये संस्थान से भी और ब्रांड के रूप में स्थापित हो गया, सेंटर ऑफ एक्सीलेंस के रूप में स्थापित हो गया, ये जो तमाम देश के संस्थानों के लिए ये बेंचमार्क एक मानदंड का एक महत्वपूर्ण केंद्र स्थापित हो गया। महामहिम हम नई शिक्षा नीति को लेकर के अभी आए हैं और जैसे कि आपका हमेशा आशीर्वाद रहा है और मुझे मालूम है कि आपने नई शिक्षा नीति को लेकर के बहुत अच्छा लेख लिखा था जो बहुत ही लोकप्रिय हुआ। महामहिम आपने हमारे मार्गदर्शन के लिए हमेशा उपस्थित रहे हैं और जिस तरीके से आपने NEP की बिंदुवार समीक्षा के लिए उत्साह वर्धन किया है, जिन मूल्य और संवैधानिक उत्तरदायित्वों का आपने चित्र किया है, निश्चित रूप में NEP 2020 उसको पूरा करेगी। या शिक्षा नीति देश को बहुभाषी भी बनाएगी, आशावादी भी बनाएगी, निष्ठावादी भी बनाएगी। आपके द्वारा जो बहुत ही महत्वपूर्ण अपील की गई है महामहिम मुझे पूरा भरोसा है कि पूरे देश ने उस अपील को बहुत ही गंभीरता से लिया है। सभी लोग उसको निश्चित रूप में उसका पालन करने की ओर भी है। उत्तर व दक्षिण को भाषा के आदान प्रदान से जोड़ने का जो आपका आह्वान है और हमेशा आपने भाषा पर जो जोर दिया है, आज वो आपके लेख के माध्यम से निश्चित रूप में जो भाषा के संपूर्ण विकल्प खोले हैं, भाषा किसी प्रदेश पे थोपी नहीं जाएगी, भाषा के संपूर्ण विकल्प और दक्षिण को पूरा, पूरब को पश्चिम, पूरे देश को एक दूसरे से जोड़ने का जो हमेशा आपका सपना रहा है, ये नई शिक्षा नीति निश्चित रूप में चरित्रवान और विश्व मानव बनाने की दिशा में भी एक बहुत महत्वपूर्ण कदम होगा। मैं समझता हूँ कि ये जो शिक्षा नीति है, नेशन फर्स्ट और करेक्टर मस्ट, हमेशा आपने कहा है, और ये शिक्षा नीति इस दिशा में बहुत गंभीर है कि वो विश्व को एक महामानव ऐसे नागरिक के रूप में हम दे सके, जिसमें श्रीमान लोकल भी होगा, ग्लोबल भी होगा, लोकस भी होगा, फोकस भी होगा, टैलेंट पैदा भी होगा, टैलेंट का विस्तार भी होगा, टैलेंट भी होगा, कंटेंट भी होगा, पेटेंट भी होगा और रिलीवेंट भी होगा। ये सभी दृष्टि से श्रीमान यदि देखें तो ये शिक्षा नीति जो दुनिया के सबसे बड़ा विमर्श हुआ होगा, मैं समझता हूं कि छात्र से लेकर के अभिभावक तक, शिक्षक से लेकर के शिक्षाविदों तक और गांव से लेकर के पार्लियामेंट तक और ग्राम प्रधान से लेकर आदरणीय प्रधानमंत्री जी तक, गरीब से लेकर के उद्योगपति तक, इसमें हर क्षेत्र में शायद दुनिया का सबसे बड़ा परामर्श हुआ होगा। लाखों लाखों करोड़ों करोड़ों की सहभागिता इस नई शिक्षा नीति में आई है। और यदि मैं इस सूत्र में महामहिम बताऊं कि जो नई शिक्षा नीति है, ये जो 5 I पर काफी कुछ निर्भर करेगी, ये इंडियन भी होगी, इंटरनेशनल भी होगी, इंटरैक्टिव भी होगी और इम्पैक्टफुल भी होगी और इंक्लूसिव भी होगी। श्रीमन ये जहां भारतीयता को के आधार पर खड़ी होगी, वहां ये अंतरराष्ट्रीय शिखर को भी चूमेगी, ये संवाद को भी लगातार बना करके रखेगी, तो ये प्रभावशाली भी होगी, ये समावेशी भी होगी। निश्चित रूप में जो देश की संस्कृति है, जो देश का ज्ञान और विज्ञान है, उसको एक नए शोध और अनुसंधान के साथ नवाचार के रूप में आगे बढ़ाने में निश्चित रूप में ये शिक्षा नीति, जिसमें कंटेंट भी होगा, पेटेंट भी होगा, ये दोनों ही चीज होंगी। और श्रीमान जैसे कि एक समय था जब देश में हम सीमाओं पर भी बहुत संकट में थे और खाद्यान्न के संकट से जब देश गुजर रहा था, तब हमारे देश के प्रधानमंत्री लाल बहादुर शास्त्री जी ने जय जवान जय किसान का नारा दिया था और पूरा देश खड़ा हो गया था। जब अटल बिहारी वाजपेयी, भारत रत्न अटल बिहारी वाजपेयी भारत के प्रधानमंत्री बने, श्रीमान आप तो उनमें रहे हैं, मैं जानता हूं आप विजनरी भी हैं और मिशनरी भी हैं, तब भी देश ने आपके काम को देखा है। जब सड़कों को आपने गांव गांव तक, ग्रामीण सड़क के एक नया अभियान हो चाहे विभिन्न अभियानों को आपने मूर्त रूप दिया, उस समय अटल बिहारी वाजपेयी जी ने जय विज्ञान का नारा दिया था और वर्तमान में हमारे देश के प्रधानमंत्री नरेंद्र मोदी जी ने जय अनुसंधान का नारा दिया है। अब जरूरत हो गई अनुसंधान की, हमको भरोसा है जो नई शिक्षा नीति, राष्ट्रीय शिक्षा नीति 2020 है, ये इस संकल्प को पूरा करेगी। हम समझते हैं कि श्रम शक्ति और ज्ञान शक्ति, इन दोनों का बेहतर हम समावेश करेंगे। अनुसंधान के क्षेत्र में भी श्रीमान हम लोग, जैसे भारत के प्रधानमंत्री जी ने कहा एक नए भारत के निर्माण की बात है, स्वच्छ भारत हो, स्वस्थ भारत हो, समृद्ध भारत हो, सशक्त भारत हो, श्रेष्ठ भारत हो, आत्मनिर्भर भारत हो और एक भारत हो, और उसका रास्ता भी मेक इन इंडिया, डिजिटल इंडिया, स्किल इंडिया, स्टार्टअप और स्टैंडअप जैसे रास्ते हमको दिए हैं। मुझे भरोसा है कि जो शोध और अनुसंधान एनआरएफ नेशनल रिसर्च फाउंडेशन हो और चाहे स्पार्क हो और चाहे स्ट्राइड हो, चाहे स्टार्स हो, चाहे इम्प्रिंट हो, चाहे इम्प्रेस हो और चाहे प्रधानमंत्री अध्येता वृत्ति हो, इसके माध्यम से निश्चित रूप में एक नए युग का सूत्रपात होगा और वो युग निश्चित रूप में भारत को विश्व में ज्ञान की महाशक्ति बनाने के रूप में सफल होगा। महामहिम मुझे लगता है कि आपका हमेशा हमको मार्गदर्शन रहा है और जो बीच में हमारे सामने चुनौती आई, जबकि इस देश के 33 करोड़ छात्र छात्राएं, दुनिया का सबसे बड़ा लोकतांत्रिक देश हिंदुस्तान में 1000 से भी अधिक विश्वविद्यालय हैं, 45,000 से भी अधिक डिग्री कॉलेज हैं, ये 15 लाख से भी अधिक स्कूल हैं, 1.9 करोड़ से भी अधिक अध्यापक हैं और कुल अमेरिका की जितनी आबादी नहीं है 33 करोड़ से भी अधिक छात्र और छात्राएं हैं। इन छात्र छात्राओं को किस तरीके से ऑनलाइन शिक्षा में, इन उन परिस्थितियों में जब छात्र घर के अंदर अपनी सुरक्षा की दृष्टि से कैद हो गया हो, ये बहुत बड़ी चुनौती थी। मैं IIT को भी आह्वान करना चाहता हूँ इस अवसर पर कि ये जो ऑनलाइन शिक्षा है इसको भी, ये जो बड़ी चुनौती है इसका भी हम लोगों को मुकाबला करना है। आपने निश्चित विभिन्न क्षेत्रों में काम किया है और जैसे प्रधानमंत्री जी ने कहा है कि वन नेशन वन डिजिटल प्लेटफॉर्म, और हमने एक वन क्लास वन चैनल की भी बात की है, ये किस तरीके से डिजिटल शिक्षा को हम आगे बढ़ा सकते हैं ये हमारे सामने चुनौती है। मुझे भरोसा है कि IIT दिल्ली ने तमाम ऐसे अभिनव प्रयोग दिए हैं, देश को मार्गदर्शन दिया है, देश की ताकत बन करके उभर करके सामने आया है। ऐसे अवसर पर जो हमारे प्रधानमंत्री जी का भी सपना है कि इसको डिजिटल इंडिया बनाना है, उस डिजिटल इंडिया की दिशा में जो हम आज ऑनलाइन एजुकेशन टेक्नोलॉजी के क्षेत्र में कैसे करके हम आगे बढ़ सकते हैं, इसके लिए NET नेशनल एजुकेशन टेक्नोलॉजी फोरम भी इस नई शिक्षा नीति के अंदर अभी हम लोग लाए हैं। मुझे भरोसा है कि IIT दिल्ली इस चुनौती को भी एक चुनौती के रूप में अपने देख करके और नए संभावनाओं को तलाशेगा, और हम विश्व, आज भी हम पूरे विश्व में पहला देश है जो 33 करोड़ छात्र छात्राओं को ऑनलाइन शिक्षा के रूप में देने के लिए सक्षम हो रहे हैं, आगे बढ़ रहे हैं। और इस अवसर पर जबकि आज हम डायमंड जुबली मना रहे हैं, एक उत्सव मना रहे हैं, हम अपने पीछे का आंकलन कर रहे हैं और भविष्य की उड़ान के लिए आज हम सब हंसी खुशी और उत्साह के वातावरण में अपने महामहिम उपराष्ट्रपति जी के संरक्षण में यहाँ पर इस आयोजन को मना रहे हैं। महामहिम, हम आपको भरोसा दिलाएंगे कि ये पूरी टीम रात दिन विजनरी है, मिशनरी है, जुनून के हिसाब से रात और दिन राष्ट्र के लिए खपने वाली ये टीम है। हम आपको कभी निराश नहीं होने देंगे क्योंकि आपने हमेशा और हमेशा हमारा मार्गदर्शन किया, आपने हमेशा जब भी हम लोगों ने आपको याद किया आप शिक्षा के क्षेत्र में हमेशा आपका आशीर्वाद मिला है। एक बार पुनः मैं इस IIT के पूरे परिवार को इस भरे उत्सव के बीच मैं बहुत सारी शुभकामनाएं देना चाहता हूं, मैं बधाई देना चाहता हूं, और अपने आज के मुख्य अतिथि हमारे मार्गदर्शक हमारे प्रेरक परम श्रद्धेय महामहिम उपराष्ट्रपति वेंकैया जी का सा आभार हृदय की गहराइयों से अभिनंदन करता हूं। बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद।
माननीय मानव संसाधन विकास मंत्री का बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद, आपने हमारे समक्ष कुछ बहुत महत्वपूर्ण बातें रखी हैं। आपने बताया IIT दिल्ली के बारे में, ये बहुत खुशी की बात है कि जब समाज और देश के सामने चुनौतियां आई हैं तो IIT दिल्ली अपने विज्ञान अनुसंधान अपने रिसर्च के साथ स्टूडेंट्स फैकल्टी स्टाफ सब जुड़े हैं उससे लड़ने के लिए। और हाल ही में जो कोविड के बारे में आपने बताया, IIT दिल्ली ने जो कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशन किया है उसमें, उसके लिए बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद आपका उसको हाईलाइट करने के लिए। आपने और हमें बताया NET के बारे में, नेशनल एजुकेशन पॉलिसी, नई शिक्षा नीति, और जो आपने चुनौती रखी है हमारे सामने कि ये जो ऑनलाइन शिक्षा है, जो 33 करोड़ बच्चे हैं, छात्र छात्राएं हैं स्कूल्स कॉलेजेस में, कैसे उन तक हम इम्पैक्टफुल, जो आपने कहा इम्पैक्टफुल, इंक्लूसिव और इंटरैक्टिव, कैसे सभी बच्चों को जोड़ा जाए जिनके पास आजकल टेक्नोलॉजी नहीं है, फोन नहीं है, कई बच्चे स्कूलों में कॉलेज में, आप कैसे हम नीतियां बनाएं, कैसे IIT दिल्ली में भी इसके ऊपर कमेटी बनके बहुत गहरा मंथन हुआ है इसके बारे में, हमने काफी कोशिश करी कि कैसे बच्चों को जोड़ा जाए जिससे एक तरफ तो हम डिजिटल इंडिया और आगे बढ़ते जा रहे हैं पर दूसरी तरफ नो वन शुड बी लेफ्ट बिहाइंड, सबको साथ में लेकर चलना है हमको आगे इस देश को बनाने के लिए। आपका बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद, हम बहुत आभारी हैं। अब हम डायमंड जुबली सेलिब्रेशंस के लिए खास तौर पर डिजाइन किए गए लोगो की प्रस्तुति करने जा रहे हैं। इस लोगो की रचना हमारे डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ डिजाइन के फैकल्टी और स्टूडेंट्स ने करी है। इसके डिजाइन में पत्तियां, वेन डायग्राम, हीरा और हमारे जाने पहचाने डोगरा हॉल की छत से प्रेरणा ली गई है। पत्तियां सस्टेनेबिलिटी और विकास का प्रतीक है। IIT में जो इंटरडिसिप्लिनरी रिसर्च होती है उसको वेन डायग्राम डिपिक्ट करता है। हीरा या डायमंड इस समारोह को और डोगरा हॉल की छत
शोध कार्य और एक्सीलेंस को सिंबलाइज करते हैं। ये अलग अलग आकृतियां इस सुंदर लोगों में समाहित होकर आईआईटी दिल्ली के मूल्यों और फ्यूचर एस्पिरेशंस को अभिव्यक्त करती हैं। We now share with you this logo that stands as a brand mark of this prestigious event, reflecting the ethos of IIT Delhi and its futuristic aspirations. Saath hi, IIT Delhi ke 2030 strategy document, 2030 ke strategy document ko bhi prastut karne ja rahe hain, jise jaise Professor Rao ne hame bataya, McKinsey company ke pro bono sahyog se IIT Delhi ne tayar kiya hai. Is 10 saal ke vision document ko tayar karne ke liye IIT Delhi के फैकल्टी, स्टूडेंट्स और स्टाफ और दुनिया भर में बसे अलुमनाई, जिनके बारे में हमने सुना थोड़ी देर पहले, उनके साथ कंसल्टेशंस किए गए एक्सटेंसिवली और फिर ये विजन डॉक्यूमेंट बना है। अब मैं माननीय उपराष्ट्रपति जी से निवेदन करती हूँ कि वे कृपया डायमंड जुबली लोगो और IIT दिल्ली के 2030 स्ट्रैटेजी डॉक्यूमेंट दोनों को रिलीज करें। I now request the Honorable Vice President of India, please.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
माननीय उपराष्ट्रपति जी, आपका बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद करते हुए अब मैं कुछ दो शब्द कहना चाहूंगी आपके बारे में। माननीय श्री एम वेंकैया नायडू ने 11 अगस्त 2017 को भारत के उपराष्ट्रपति का पद संभाला। उन्होंने अपने राजनीतिक जीवन में किसानों और पिछड़े इलाकों से जुड़े मुद्दों को पुरजोर तरीके से उठाया है। 2000 से 2002 तक वे ग्रामीण विकास मंत्री रहे। राष्ट्र के विकास में इनके कई योगदानों में विशिष्ट है इस दौरान इम्प्लीमेंट करी गई प्रधानमंत्री ग्राम सड़क योजना, जिसके बारे में माननीय मंत्री जी ने भी हमें बताया। इस योजना से कई गांव को अपनी पहली पक्की सड़क मिली है हमारे देश में। माननीय श्री नायडू शहरी विकास मंत्री, संसदीय कार्य मंत्री और सूचना और प्रसारण मंत्री भी रह चुके हैं। अपनी तमाम राजनीतिक व्यस्तताओं के बावजूद वे राजनीतिक और लोकहित के विषयों पर लगातार प्रमुख अखबारों में लिखने का समय निकालते हैं और पब्लिक डिबेट में योगदान देते हैं। माननीय श्री नायडू के कार्यकाल में राज्यसभा सुचारू रूप से चल रही है। 2019 के अंत में संचालित राज्यसभा के 250वें सत्र में ऑलमोस्ट 100% प्रोडक्टिविटी का रिकॉर्ड रहा है। अब मैं माननीय उपराष्ट्रपति जी से निवेदन करती हूं कि वे कृपया हमें संबोधित करके हमारा मान बढ़ाएं।
केंद्र में शिक्षा मंत्री डॉक्टर रमेश पोखरियाल जी, आईआईटी दिल्ली का निदेशक आचार्य रामगोपाल राव जी और ये डायमंड जुबली सेलिब्रेशन कमेटी का चेयरपर्सन आचार्य सहा जी और पूर्व निदेशक फैकल्टी मेंबर्स और छात्र मित्रों, राज इस समारोह में भाग लेने वाले सभी मित्रों, साथ ही साथ आचार्य विवेक गुहा, आचार्य बालकृष्णन जी, आचार्य ऋचा कुमार जी और अन्य मित्र जो इसमें भागीदारी हो रहे, मैं सबसे पहले IIT दिल्ली को शुभकामना देना चाहता हूं। किसी भी संस्थान के जीवन यात्रा में 60 वर्ष महत्वपूर्ण पड़ा होता है। इस अवसर पर मैं इस संस्थान के वर्तमान और पूर्व विद्यार्थियों, शिक्षकों और कर्मचारियों का हार्दिक अभिनंदन करता हूं, उन्हें शुभकामनाएं देता हूं। IIT दिल्ली has made a rapid stride in the last 6 decades and today is counted among the reputed institutions in the world. Just now we heard the report of the director about various achievements of this institute. It is also recognized by Government of India as an institute of eminence. It is heartening to note that overall India's unicorns have come out of this single institute, half of the India's unicorns. I'm aware that IIT Delhi graduates are present across the world and have made an impact in different spheres of life, be it as technocrats, researchers and scientists, or writers, or even as politicians. I'm told that many IIT faculty members have been winners of Padma Awards, Bhatnagar Prizes, fellows of national and international academies, and winners of other notable recognitions across the globe. The contribution of the faculty plays an important role in shaping an institution. I must pay compliments to all the faculty members of IIT Delhi. I'm told that this institute is planning to file over 200 patents this year, as against 153 patents filed in the year 2019. I'm also happy to note that IIT Delhi has emerged as a leader in the entrepreneurship space in the country. It is good to note that institutes such as IIT Delhi are producing job providers rather than job seekers and becoming trendsetter for the other institutes in the country. That is what is notable and what is required. I have also been informed that IIT Delhi is the first institution in the country to launch an endowment fund, and the alumni of IIT Delhi are following the motto of giving back to the country. That indeed reflects the essence of India's culture of sharing and caring. Share and care is the core of Indian philosophy. I always stress on that. I feel it is the duty of every Indian who achieved success, fame and wealth in life to give back to the society and the country. One should never forget one's own native place and the motherland, mother tongue, the mentors, and the institute they have studied. This is very important. My dear students and faculty members, we are interacting in the midst of a pandemic that has disrupted every sphere of activity and impacted the world economy. I'm happy that the IITs across the country have taken up several projects relating to COVID-19, including development of low-cost ventilators, PPEs, testing kits, sanitization, robots, and other equipment, apart from artificial intelligence studies on epidemic patterns and disease dynamics. While finding answers to various challenges posed by COVID-19, we should be better prepared to tackle any future pandemic. For that to happen, there should be greater collaboration and synergy between experts from different domains. I would like to IIT Delhi and other institutions to look into this aspect also. The research at IITs and other higher education institutions must be relevant to society and focus on finding solutions to various problems faced by mankind, from climate change to health issues. We must make the people's life healthy, make them happy. Mere wealth cannot give you happiness, it has been proved. Health, wealth, and also the happiness that comes out of more and more research, new ways, new ideas. There is also a need to promote multidisciplinary research and industry-academia linkage. The higher education institutions must not work in solos and seek to connect with the industry. There should be a symbiotic relationship between the two to take up cutting-edge technology. At the same time, there should be greater investment in R&D projects which focus on finding solutions to society's problems. I call upon the private sector, including the industry bodies like CAA, ASSOCHAM, FICCI, and all other organizations, to collaborate with academia in identifying such projects and fund them liberally. In fact, the industry experts in various areas should act as mentors in guiding researchers. This type of quicker results. Every industry must promote some research, and they should feel proud that they have supported so-and-so research, and this is the result of the same. I'm told that IIT Delhi is laying great emphasis on internationalization, interdisciplinary research, and industry connect. These steps are very important for our institutions to improve their international standing and become visible to the industry and society by providing solutions to the problems. As our Honorable Prime Minister, Sri Narendra Bhai Modi, has always maintained, while science is global, technologies are local. Indian institutions will be counted among the world's best only when they start impacting the societies around them by developing optimal and sustainable solutions to the problems faced by the nation. This is the way forward for Indian institutions to be counted among the world's best and for nation to regain its rightful place as Vishwa Guru. Once upon a time, India was considered as Vishwa Guru. The world used to look to India. IITs must take the lead in this journey. My dear sisters and brothers and youngsters, India's long and illustrious history of holistic education must be remembered. The aim of education in ancient India was not just the acquisition of knowledge, but also of wisdom, complete realization, and liberation of the self. The ancient Indian education system had produced scholars like Charaka, Susruta, Aryabhatta, Bhaskaracharya, Chanakya, Patanjali, and numerous others, experts in various fields. They made seminal contribution to the collective knowledge of the world in diverse fields such as mathematics, astronomy, metallurgy, medical science and surgery, civil engineering and architecture, shipbuilding and navigation, yoga, fine arts, chess, and among others. I am happy to note that the new education policy seeks to promote India as a global study destination, providing premium education at affordable cost. Premium education at affordable cost, thereby helping to restore its role as Vishwa Guru. The move to facilitate selected universities from among the top 100 universities in the world to operate in India will also help in promoting excellence in education. The National Education Policy also mentioned that internationalization of education will be facilitated through both institutional collaboration and student-faculty mobility. The proposal to set up an inter-university center For international education, Indian universities will go a long way in promoting international standards and institutional collaborations. I am confident that the new policy will create the necessary ecosystem in the coming years for Indian institutions to vastly improve global rankings. As per the QS World University Ranking 2021, only three Indian institutions figured in the top 200. Indian Institute of Technology, IIT Mumbai, at 172nd position. Indian Institute of AISE, Bangalore, 185th position. And IIT Delhi at 193rd position. There's also only eight Indian institutes found a place in the top 500 of QS World University Ranking 2021. This situation has to be changed, and there has to be concerted corrective action from all the stakeholders, governments, universities, educationalists, and private sector, to bring about a radical improvement in the standards of quality of education of our institutes of higher learning. There is a huge potential for India to become a world leader in various technological domains. Given the demographic advantage and the presence of highly talented youth, 65% of our Indian population is below 35 years, and 50% of our population is below 25 years. The need of the hour is to impart quality education, convert this vast pool of educational manpower into highly skilled workforce in tune with the requirements of the digitally driven, knowledge-based 21st century. In fact, we have the capability to not only meet the requirements in the country, but many other nations, particularly those with the aging populations. My dear sisters and brothers and dear youngsters, as I told you, with more than 50% of our population below 25 years, you must also note that more than 50% of our population still depends on agriculture. It's very, very important. It is important for IITs to start major research programs to boost the rural economy through development of sustainable technologies. I'm happy to note that IIT Delhi is the National Coordinating Institute for the Unnat Bharat Abhiyan program of the Ministry of Education and is playing a strong catalyst role. I'm told that Unnat Bharat Abhiyan already has more than 2,000 participating institutions which have adopted more than 10,000 villages. Before concluding, I would like to congratulate IIT Delhi for completing 60 years of its journey and for the numerous contributions the institution has made for the national development. I would like to compliment the successive directors, the staff members, and the youngsters who came up with the new inventions. IITs are the pride of the nation, and the country has huge expectations from these institutions and looks upon them for science and technological leadership in the years to come. Today, well, the world is moving faster. We are all seeing that India is again recognized and respected thanks to various reforms by successive governments, particularly by the present Prime Minister, who gave a slogan: reform, perform, and transform. Transforming the lives of the people, not only our countrymen, but also the world. That is our aim. That should be our aim. And you are all seeing today that even in American president's election, everybody is stressing about their support for India and its stand on many issues. Just the other day, we celebrated 74th Independence Day. To commemorate the Independence Day, the iconic Empire State Building in New York, Burj Khalifa in Dubai, and popular tourist destination Niagara Falls in Toronto were among many popular places that were lit up in tricolors across the world. There are many like that. This is the India's image. We, yeah, in our country, the particularly the younger generation, they must focus their attention on new inventions, this incubation, new interventions, new ideas. All these things should come from the youngsters. And the IITs are the centers to promote such ideas. I hope in the coming days that IIT Delhi and IITs across the nation, they will all raise to meet the aspiration of the people further. They are doing a great job, but they should come up with many more inventions. Invention to improve the lives of the mankind. Inventions to improve the peace around the globe. Inventions to accelerate the progress. Inventions to see that we move towards an equitable world order where there is no exploitation. We in India, we always talk of Ramarajya, where there is no exploitation, where there is no corruption, where there is no discrimination, be it gender or be it social or any other discrimination. We should again focus on those concepts and come out with new ideas. This online is a new idea. But how do you get everybody in line without standing in line? That should be the line of study in the coming days, line of invention in the coming days. Reaching out to the people, and also the major problem that is faced is governments are coming, they are coming with so many good ideas. Different political parties, they are offering so many good things. But how do you reach people? Delivery is more important. Delivery. And then where there is no need to go and meet or greet anybody. How do you get things done? Basic things including. That should be the focus in the coming days. How do you increase production, particularly agriculture production? More focus on proteinous food. And then the scientists, the researchers, they should focus more on, as I told you, achieving world peace. Then focus more on ecological balance. This is another important challenge before the country. This pandemic is an outcome because we neglected nature. Then how do you combine nature, culture together for a better future? That should be the way forward for all of us. And my dear youngsters who are all attending this function today, please focus your energies on these constructive things. Developing a positive attitude, and moving forward to make our lives more happy. I hope that IIT Delhi will make further strides in the coming days to come and then move on. Thank you very much. Namaskar. Jai Hind.
माननीय उपराष्ट्रपति जी ने हमारा मार्गदर्शन किया है और हमें प्रेरित भी किया है. उन्होंने दो बहुत महत्वपूर्ण बातें रखी हैं हमारे सामने चुनौती की तौर पर. पहला तो क्लाइमेट चेंज, ये जो बड़ा गहरा संकट हमारे ऊपर आ गया है, पूरे विश्व के ऊपर आ गया है, कैसे हम अपने अनुसंधान, अपने शोध के साथ सस्टेनेबल सॉल्यूशंस, सस्टेनेबल टेक्नोलॉजीज और इकोलॉजिकल बैलेंस को बनाए रखने की प्रक्रिया कैसे हम तैयार करें। उन्होंने कहा कि हमने नेचर को निग्लेक्ट करा है और कैसे हम नेचर के साथ जुड़ के नेचर को साथ में लेके ना कि उसको डिस्ट्रॉय करके कैसे हम आगे अपने लाइफस्टाइल में परिवर्तन लेके आए, हमारे इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर, हमारे टेक्नोलॉजी में कैसे परिवर्तन लेके आए, इसके ऊपर आईआईटी जैसे इंस्टीट्यूशंस को बहुत ध्यान पूर्वक इस पे चर्चा करनी होगी, विचार करना होगा, अनुसंधान करना होगा और हम पूरे तरीके से इस चुनौती को स्वीकार करते हैं सर। दूसरा उन्होंने कहा कि कैसे हम इंक्लूसिव और इक्विटेबल दुनिया बनाए, देश भी नहीं दुनिया, और उसमें कैसे आईआईटी दिल्ली जैसे इंस्टीट्यूशन इसमें कैसे ग्लोबल लीडरशिप का रोल प्ले करें, कैसे विश्व में हम रोल मॉडल बने। हम इंडिया में तो इंस्टीट्यूशन ऑफ एमिनेंस बन गए हैं पर हम इंडस्ट्री के साथ कंधा मिलाते हुए अन्य विश्वविद्यालयों के साथ, यूनिवर्सिटीज, इंस्टीट्यूट के साथ जुड़ के हम कैसे कोलैबोरेटिव तरीके निकालें कि जो भारत के सामने कई ये पैंडेमिक से कोविड के साथ जो बहुत सारी चुनौतियां आई हैं कैसे हम आगे बढ़ के इनका सामना करें। उन्होंने ये भी दर्शाया कुछ तरीकों से जैसे आईआईटी दिल्ली ने एग्रीकल्चर में कोविड के समय में कैसे काम किया है, उसके लिए हम धन्यवाद देते हैं। पर आपकी जो चुनौती है कि हम विश्व में कैसे लोगों की लाइफ ट्रांसफॉर्म करें फॉर द बेटर, ये हम स्वीकार करते हैं और आपके मार्गदर्शन के लिए हम आपके बहुत बहुत आभारी हैं। थैंक यू फॉर शेयरिंग योर वैल्यूएबल इनसाइट्स विद अस सर। वी आर रियली रियली ऑनर्ड टू हैव यू बी अ पार्ट ऑफ दिस प्रोग्राम टुडे फॉर हैविंग एक्सेप्टेड आवर इनविटेशन। थैंक यू वेरी मच। अब मैं प्रोफेसर एस के साहा, प्रोफेसर ऑफ मैकेनिकल इंजीनियरिंग एंड चेयरपर्सन ऑफ द डायमंड जुबली कमेटी, उनसे निवेदन करती हूँ कि वे कुछ वर्ड्स ऑफ थैंक्स कहें।
थैंक यू, नमस्कार। इट इज माई प्राउड प्रिविलेज to propose a vote of thanks on this auspicious occasion. First, let me thank from the core of my heart to our Honorable Vice President of India, Sri M. Venkaiah Naidu, for kindly agreeing to be the chief guest of our virtual inauguration of the Diamond Jubilee celebration at a very short notice and gracing this function today. I'm sure his presence has elevated the prestige of the inaugural function. We are grateful to you, sir. I take this opportunity to thank also our guest of honor, Sri Ramesh Pokhriyal Nishank, Honorable Union Minister of MHRD. Thank you, sir, for being present in this function at a short notice and hope to guide us throughout the year of our celebration. Let me thank our Director, Professor V. Ramgopal Rao, for providing the leadership at IIT Delhi and giving direction towards the planning of this Diamond Jubilee celebration. I must acknowledge the support of our two deputy directors, Professor T. C. Khanpal and Professor A. K. Ganguly, for their advices since the beginning of this event. Let me thank our colleague, Professor Richa Kumar, too, for comparing today's function nicely. Last but not the least, it is my moral duty to thank my co-chairman, Professor Vivek Guha, all other team members of this Diamond Jubilee Celebration Committee, which includes students, staff members, and faculty representatives of IIT Delhi for their hard work, all fraternity of IIT Delhi, and n number of viewers around the world, without whom the program would not be remembered in future. Jai Hind.
Thank you, Professor Saha. आज के कार्यक्रम के विशिष्ट अतिथियों ने अपना अत्यंत बिजी शेड्यूल से इस ऐतिहासिक समारोह के लिए समय निकाला, इसके लिए हम उनके आभारी हैं। आप सब पार्टिसिपेंट्स ने भी अपना बहुमूल्य समय इस कार्यक्रम के लिए दिया, इसके लिए मैं आईआईटी दिल्ली की तरफ से
A participant has left the meeting.
Bucky. Good morning to all of you. On behalf of IIT Delhi, it's my pleasure to welcome you all to the second session of the virtual inaugural ceremony of the Diamond Jubilee celebrations of IIT Delhi. In this session, we have two distinguished speakers. The first talk will be delivered by Professor Devang Kakkar, distinguished alumnus of IIT Delhi and the former director IIT Bombay. A warm welcome to you, Professor Kakkar. The second talk will be delivered by Professor Balakrishnan. He is a professor on leave from Department of Computer Science and Engineering of IIT Delhi and is currently the Vice Chancellor of the Satya Bharti Institute of Technology, being founded by the Bharti Group. Welcome, Professor Balakrishnan. It is our pleasure to have you as a distinguished speaker. As we have seen the Institute to grow for more than three decades and contributed to its growth in different capacities. After these two inaugural talks, we have a panel discussion on IIT Delhi, reminiscing 60 years of excellence and the way forward. And for this, I welcome the former directors of IIT Delhi, Professor V.S. Raju, Professor R.S. Sirohi, Professor Surendra Prasad, and Professor R.K. Shevgaonkar, who have contributed immensely to the growth of the Institute and to the glorious journey of the Institute to be the Institute of Eminence, what it is today. They will share their memories, challenges that they faced, and suggestions for future to take the Institute to the new heights. On behalf of faculty, students, and staff of IIT Delhi and its alumni, a warm welcome to all of you, Professor Raju, Professor Sirohi, Professor Surendra Prasad, and Professor Shivgamkar. This panel discussion will be moderated by Professor Ram Gopal Rao, the Director of IIT Delhi. Now, I would like to introduce to you the first distinguished speaker, Professor Devang Kakkar. Professor Kakkar did his B.Tech from IIT Delhi in 1981 and PhD from University of Massachusetts Amherst in 1986. Thereafter, he joined the Department of Chemical Engineering IIT Bombay in 1987 and has been with IIT Bombay since then. Professor Kakkar has served as professor in charge of IIT Bombay's continuing education program, head of chemical engineering department, dean faculty affairs, and he has also been the director of IIT Bombay since 2009 to 2019. Professor Kakkar's research interests include mechanics of granular flows, polymer processing, and for his research achievements, Professor Kakkar has been accorded with several prestigious awards, which include the most coveted Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize in Engineering Sciences in 1997, Swarna Jayanti Fellowship in 1998, and the Millennium Gold Medal of the Indian Science Congress in 2000. Professor Kakkar is also recipient of IIT Bombay's Excellence in Teaching Award and the Mathur Award for Research Excellence. In recognition of his contributions, IIT Delhi conferred upon him the Distinguished Alumnus Award in the year 2008. He is a fellow of National Academy of Engineering, the Indian National Science Academy, the Academy of Sciences, and the National Academy of Sciences in India. He serves on Science Advisory Council to the Prime Minister of India, Scientific Advisory Committee to the Cabinet, and the Central Advisory Board of Education, and the Atomic Energy Regulatory Board.
Professor Kakkar, now I would like to invite you to deliver your inaugural talk.
Thank you very much, Professor Bua, Professor Ram Gopal Rao, Director of IIT Delhi, Professor Khandpal, Professor Ganguly, Deputy Directors, Professor Saha and Professor Bua, Chairpersons of the Diamond Jubilee Committee, former Directors of IIT Delhi, Professor Raju, Professor Sirohi, Professor Surendra Prasad and Professor Shiv Gaonkar, Vice Chancellor, Professor Balakrishnan, who has of course served IIT Delhi in many capacities over the years, distinguished invitees, colleagues on the faculty and staff of IIT Delhi, alumni, students, ladies and gentlemen. My greetings and good wishes to all members of the Institute on this auspicious occasion. I feel truly honored to deliver a talk at the inaugural of the Diamond Jubilee of my alma mater, IIT Delhi. As has been said by our Vice President, the Diamond Jubilee is an important milestone in the growth of any institute, and in particular in the growth of this institute. And for me, it's really a matter of joy that the road from the inception of the institute to this milestone has essentially been studded with many successes and very high achievements. On this occasion, as we just start this year-long celebration of the Diamond Jubilee, I'd like to congratulate all the faculty, the staff, and students of the Institute, past and present, for taking the Institute forward in its path to glory. I joined IIT Delhi as a BTech student in the summer of 1976. The Institute was young, just 15 years old, and younger than me because I was 17 at that time, and small. My batch just had 220 students, and I understand today there are more than 1,000 students in the undergraduate batch each year. But from the viewpoint of education, it was fully formed, and I realized this only later, as I will explain. I feel that it's very difficult for a student to judge the quality of education that she or he is receiving. You know, the teachers are good, the work seems interesting, but you never know how useful or how important the things that you are being taught are and will be for your future life. This was the case with me. And it was only when I went for postgraduate studies that I realized what a superlative education I had received at IIT Delhi. The 5 years at the Institute were truly transformative for me. And I will always be grateful to the Institute for the really strong foundation that I received, the lifelong friends that I made, and the teachers who guided me, not just while I was at IIT, but even for years afterwards. After completing my PhD, I have been teaching at IIT Bombay since 1987. During these 33 years, I have been associated with IIT Delhi in various ways. I would like to share my thoughts today on this, you know, day when we are going to start this year-long celebrations. So I would like to share my thoughts on why, in my opinion, IIT Delhi is so successful and why it remains a magical place for students and faculty alike. I have made a short presentation, which is sort of general. It talks about history and the past, and there are many people here who are listening who can certainly add to what I will say, because they have a first-hand experience, and of course we look forward to what they will say, particularly the former directors, in the next session where they have the discussion on the future of IIT Delhi. So let me just share my slides. So I've titled my talk as IIT Delhi, the Path to Excellence. Really, I mean, the story starts in the vision that the founders had for high quality engineering education. And it was just after the Second World War when there was a need felt for high quality engineers in India. And the Sarkar committee was set up by the Viceroy's Academic Council in 1946 to prepare a blueprint for setting up four higher technical institutes. Of course, we have to understand this is pre-independence, but they were still preparing for the future. The committee comprised the most eminent scientists and academicians of the country. And
Sir, Kakar, we are not seeing your slides for some reason. It's coming on the YouTube. That's okay. Okay, that's okay. I think it's all right. Please go ahead. No, on the YouTube, it's coming in. That's all.
So, okay. So should I just continue?
Watch it on YouTube. That's all right. Please go ahead.
Okay. Thank you. So, Nalini Ranjan Sarkar, who was the chairman of this committee, was a businessman and a politician. And this committee, of course, there were lots of debates and, you know, you can read about it. There were dissenting notes and all these things. The report is available on the web. But finally, the committee submitted an interim report, and that has served as the blueprint for the IITs. You know, I thought that I will just pick out a few of the recommendations and, summarize them, because I felt that those really had a major impact. So this is, of course, you know, what I found on the web of the report, and it's been submitted to the member of the Viceroy's Executive Council, the Department of Health, of Education, Health and Agriculture. And these are some of the recommendations. One of the recommendations read that the selection of students should be purely on merit and there should be no provincial quotas. An entrance board should give a written exam to the applicants. Another one reads, the education and training should be on modern lines and the standard should not be lower than a first-class institution abroad. And they mentioned BSc Tech from Manchester or BS from MIT. And then another one says, the education should provide a fundamental scientific training to teach him fundamental theories of engineering so the student can apply these with confidence many years later. It also says that it should also provide a broad human outlook to assist in the development of character and mental ability so that he may become a useful citizen. Some more recommendations that I pulled out. It is also necessary that these institutes produce research workers and technical teachers. And they recommended that the undergraduate to postgraduate student ratio should be 2:1. Of course, today, as Professor Ram Gopal Rao mentioned, we have more postgraduates than undergraduates, so it's closer to 1:1. But certainly, this is a very important recommendation made in 1946. They also mentioned there should be enough teachers to maintain a ratio of 10:1, so 10 students per teacher. They say that teachers be expected to do only so much teaching work as would leave them sufficient leisure for research work, for which they should be given all reasonable facilities. I think it's interesting that research work is regarded as leisure activity. I think this is something that all our colleagues can certainly be take a little bit of fun out of. And then finally, the control of the institute be entrusted to a small governing body composed of persons with the requisite variety of qualifications and experience. So I have actually just, these I'm quoting directly from the report, and you can see that many of these things are very familiar to us because this is how the institutes went forward. And if you actually look at the history, post-independence, there was a very strong support for setting up of these institutions right from the top. And if I quote India's first Prime Minister, Jawaharlal Nehru, who was a very strong supporter of the idea, he said at, you know, one of the inaugural ceremonies, "I suppose that among the many things that are being done in India today, the establishment of the great institutes of technical training and knowledge is perhaps the most important." So the first institute, IIT Kharagpur, came up in 1951, entirely funded by public funds. But then there was a gap for 7 years, and all the four other institutes were set up in the from 58 to 61. And then in 1961, there was the Institutes of Technology Act, which was passed. And this essentially gives a great autonomy to the institute, including the power to grant degrees. So here is how the institutes were set up: Kharagpur in 51, then Bombay in 58, Madras in 59, Kanpur in 60, and Delhi in 61. And, you know, in each of these, Bombay was supported by USSR, Madras by Germany, Kanpur by USA, and Delhi by UK. You know, and from what we recall, and, you know, if we go through our own histories, then all these five IITs, they followed the blueprint of the Sarkar committee quite faithfully. I think this is, you know, we see this in the joint entrance exam and in many other things, the science-based engineering program, the sort of establishment of humanities and social sciences in the institute right from the start and so forth. The second point is that really excellent faculty and students joined the institutes from their inception. And, you know, there was a great a concerted effort when the institute started, not just by the directors of the institute, but even our ambassadors in different countries were sort of roped in to encourage people who are doing PhD to come back and join the institutes as faculty. The initial investments were, of course, quite low, and research was slow to start, but the standard of education was excellent right from the start. And the educational programs were recognized quite early to be of an international standard. A consequence was, of course, that a very large fraction of the students were able to get admissions to universities abroad, and many of them migrated, a large majority to the US, causing this huge brain drain. But many, of course, went there and went abroad and all stayed in India, but most of them excelled in their professions. If you sort of look at what was the impact they had, there was a very significant impact right from the start, because a very significant fraction joined the Indian industry in academia. And Professor Sukhatme from IIT Bombay did a survey and found that as many as 65% of the graduates actually remained in India. And they made major contributions. Many of them played an important role in the IT revolution when it came. Many contributed to the manufacturing sector. We saw many joining the management institutes and then becoming top managers in companies and so forth. And a large number became entrepreneurs. By some estimates, as many as 25% of those who remained became entrepreneurs. And they were, you know, the pioneers of the startup ecosystem, as Professor Ram Gopal Rao mentioned. IIT Delhi has been particularly successful in promoting this. And then, of course, several went into government, NGOs, and so forth. And so there is a really wide impact that these graduates had on India itself. But if you look at, you know, two decades at a time, then in the first two decades, which I would say the beginnings, there was support from the very top. There was a lot of effort in building the campus, developing a novel curriculum, which was science and humanities grounded. And that was quite a new experiment in Indian technical education. But of course, one of the major ingredients in this phase was this autonomy that they had to essentially design the kind of curriculum that they thought was best. The next two decades saw some sort of, you know, criticism of the system. There was a lot of shortage of funds. And if you looked at, you know, the media, and one of our colleagues did a, you know, quite a survey of this. And if you look at all the newspaper reports around this time, most of them were focusing on the brain drain, the ivory tower existence, and many stories on how these institutes were only for the benefit of the West. But in spite of all this, in all the institutes, there was quite aggressive faculty recruitment, and this was really an investment for the future. But in spite of all this, there was great admiration for the joint entrance exam and the internal functioning of the institutions, which everyone realized worked like clockwork. And it was the one educational system in which trust could be placed. And then if you look at the third two decades, you know, there was a sort of complete change in attitude. And if you look at many of the headlines at that time, it says IITs recover their shine and pride, degrees of high renown, IITs better than US institutes, says CBS. This was that documentary in 60 Minutes that came out. And really this helped along greatly by alumni and was helped along by alumni and a resurgent economy after the liberalization. There was a sort of restoration of public faith. Yeah, alumni were evidence of IIT's excellence in technical education. There was quite a bit of international recognition. And in this phase, there was a much greater emphasis on research. So if you look now at, let's say, IIT Delhi today, and, you know, I think that the presentation and the speech by the director, Professor Ram Gopal Rao, gave a wonderful summary of where IIT Delhi is today. And it's certainly on an upswing. It's on a great trajectory. And, you know, we're very proud of all the achievements and what we hope will be the future achievements. And some of the trends that I personally really welcome is that the focus on teaching remains strong. I think that's really the core of IITs, and that should remain strong. and IIT Delhi is delivering a world-class education both at the undergraduate and postgraduate level. I think this is the core, and I think it should remain the core. But another very welcome trend is that there is an increasing breadth beyond engineering. And Professor Rao mentioned some of these things. Policy research is becoming important and so forth. And biomedical has always been a very great strength of IIT Delhi. And I think that there is broadening of the scope of education that IIT is providing. And I think that's very important. There is growing research strength. And, you know, just the way in which new ideas have come up to address the COVID epidemic shows the ability of the institute to address societal problems because of the capabilities in terms of knowledge and expertise. You know, there have been strong linkages built up with industry, with international universities, and something that's really welcome, that alumni are playing a more and more important role. I think all of these three are very important. And because of the performance of the institute, there is a great trust by the government in the institute. And we heard this from the remarks of the Honorable Vice President as well. Another trend which is very important and which is bearing great fruit is the support for entrepreneurship. And finally, the improved standing in international ranking is also a very nice sort of bit of news. And I think we would like to see the rankings go higher and higher because it does make a difference. What, in my mind, are the ingredients for the success? One is the faculty. I think faculty are really at the center of everything. And the institutes have had the freedom to recruit high caliber faculty, and they have done this. And I hope they will continue to do so, because the faculty is what is IIT Delhi. Second very important thing is students and the merit-based admission that we have. I think that's really wonderful, and it does make a huge difference to the standard of education that we can provide. The third ingredient is autonomy. There is great freedom to modify curriculum, start new courses, and so forth. And there's great flexibility in decision-making. And so students themselves can come up with ideas and the administration listens. And, you know, no rule is sort of fixed forever. So these kinds of flexibilities make a huge difference. There was a strong blueprint at the start, and I think we were adhered to it. Of course, we've gone beyond many of the recommendations, as I mentioned. But it was important to have it. And I'm very happy that that McKinsey has now prepared this strategic plan. I'm sure that that will be a very important document for the years ahead. And there is this expectation of excellence. High standards were set at the start, and even today we saw that from the highest levels, there is an expectation that IIT Delhi will do better and better. And I think this expectation is important, and we also should have this expectation with us. And finally, funding. We've got generous support from the government over the years and from various well-wishers. And I think this has been also one of the great ingredients of the success of the institute. I'd like to just end by wishing that the next 70 years bring even greater successes. And I want to thank you once again for inviting me on this very auspicious occasion to say a few words. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Kakkar, very much for sharing your thoughts, taking us in the journey through how IIT has evolved, and in particular, you know, how IIT Delhi grew and the way forward. So thank you very much. I now would like to invite our second distinguished speaker, Mr. M. Balakrishnan. He is a professor on leave from Department of Computer Science and Engineering of IIT Delhi and is currently the Vice Chancellor of the Greenfield Institution of Eminence named Satya Bharati Institute of Technology, being founded by the Bharati Group. Mr. Balakrishnan obtained his bachelor's degree in electronics and electrical engineering from BITS Pilani in 1977, PhD from Electrical Engineering Department from IIT Delhi in 1985. For last 32 years, he has been involved in teaching and research in areas of digital systems design, electronic design automation, and embedded systems. At IIT Delhi, he has been the Phillips Chair Professor, Head of the Department for Computer Science and Engineering, Dean Postgraduate Studies and Research, Deputy Director Faculty, and finally, the Deputy Director Strategy and Planning. At IIT Delhi, he has initiated a number of programs and activities to promote research, startups, as well as outreach to the community. AssistTech, a laboratory and research group founded by him along with other colleagues, is involved in developing a number of assistive devices targeted towards mobility and education of visually impaired. SmartCane is a mobility aid for visually impaired developed by his group, which is currently being used by thousands of users in India and other countries. He has been recipient of 3 national awards. Importantly, the ACM Eugene L. Lawler Award, and very recently, IIT Delhi's Lifetime Award for his work in the disability space. He is also a fellow of Indian National Academy of Engineering. Mr. Balakrishnan, thank you very much for joining, and now I invite you to deliver your inaugural talk.
Thank you. First of all, I'd like to thank the Diamond Jubilee Committee for giving me this opportunity to share some thoughts. I was looking for a platform where I could share these thoughts because the long association that IIT Delhi, there's many things, and also as Vivek read out, I also had an opportunity to serve at various levels of responsibility. And these thoughts essentially, I summarize my experiences. First of all, I'd like to dedicate this talk to Professor P.V. Indiresan, one of the, foremost thinkers that at least I have come across which this institution has produced. And also had the opportunity to serve when I joined this institute first time in 1977. So just my journey very briefly. So there are 3 parts of my journey till now, after I graduated from BITS Pilani in 77. First 8 years I served in IIT Delhi in 4 different positions. So that also perhaps I'm one of the few people who held many designations in this institute. Then 3 years I was abroad working in universities. And then, from 1988, end of 88 onwards, I have been with IIT Delhi. So all of these parts of the journey are very important to whatever I'm going to say, because at each place I learned a lot and I also had an opportunity to observe how great things happen. Many times when we sort of get frustrated and complain, we don't realize that what is it that we have achieved and why is it that, how is it we have achieved. Devang has actually put this very good background to this particular talk, because he has talked about a number of things starting from Sarkar Commission report, which actually enabled us to do it. So clearly what we have achieved is a national reputation and what we have achieved is a global visibility. And this talk is about, from global visibility, how can we convert it into global eminence? Because we still are not there as a globally eminent, but we are globally visible. It's also important to know that no other Indian organizational or institutional clusters have achieved both. Many of them have national reputation and a few of them have some global visibility. In fact, some of it, even pre-independence and early part of independence, there are institutions which had such a global visibility and national reputation, but they have not been able to maintain it. So this particular aspect is neither a coincidence nor a mean achievement, and there is something to be proud of for having achieved that. But let's be very clear why it happened. Devang has already mentioned about it, academic, regulatory, and financial. All these three autonomy has been extremely important for whatever we have achieved. I'll not go into detail because there's a lot of details that are talked about, but I will just give you each time, you know, I like to give some examples. Just look at, let's say, if we were to be governed by regulations of UGC and AICT. Just look at the criteria for promoting faculty members that these institutions specify. If we were to follow that, what type of mediocrity that we would have actually bred here. So the fact that we were out of these regulations is an extremely important thing. So, you know, because this is something that we need to be celebrated. IITs have also benefited from a very unique collaborative competition model. This is something very unique, I would say, globally. We compete for students, we compete for faculty, we compete for almost everything among each other, but we also collaborate very well. Hundreds of opportunities where faculty members meet each other, either in PhD Vivas, either in GATE, or whether in, you know, as a coordination committee for JEE, coordination committee for GATE. There are so many projects which are running across IITs. And these meetings are extremely important because what it does is we learn from good practices. So I will later on talk about some of the changes that have happened. These changes have not happened because of the policy at the IIT Council level, which is would have been possible. Many of these changes have happened because we understand that something good happened at another IIT. We are able to come back. And within the IIT system, it's very interesting. It is easy to actually get something passed if you say that Madras has done it, or Bombay has done it, or Kanpur has done it. So good practices initiative at one place results in transformations at all other places. And this is no coincidence that all the five older IITs were more or less very similar. You know, you can only say Twindledum and Twindledee. So there was not too much of a difference in terms of their performance. It is not a coincidence. It happened because initiatives at one place always were. I'll talk a little bit about it. Faculty recruitment is something which I would say that we have evolved the best. We put our minds to it over the decades, and I will show you the type of changes that have happened where we exercised our flexibility and autonomy to the maximum extent is in faculty recruitment. Governance model, all of us have benefited a lot by empowering the faculty. This is a governance model that actually I would say has made a huge difference, especially in the last 20, 25 years. JEE already, Devang talked about it, let me not say more about it. It has contributed very strongly to IIT brand. Let me talk about the faculty recruitment. 1960s onwards, in absentia appointments. Not even a telephonic interview was required. You will send a CV, somebody will evaluate the CV, and then based on the CV, somebody will make an offer. I think many of us in this place, at least the senior people, I came to this as a faculty member by this process. Many of my colleagues came from this process, and it was not like one or two, some exceptional people were appointed. This was appointed in bulk. Large number of faculty members were actually appointed through this process. So I do not know whether other institutions had this opportunity. So if they had not, if they have actually insisted on in-person interviews, I think the faculty profile at IIT, an academic profile at IIT would have been completely different. So this is something whoever, and all the institutions follow this. Something very interesting happened after 1980s. All IITs decided one by one, including ISC and IITs, that we will not inbreed. We will not take our own faculty, PhD student, and appoint them as faculty. This is a slow transition process, not a decision at the council, some level that, you know, it would have been even thought to be discriminatory if you actually make this as a rule, but this was practice, you know, put in practice. And this actually changed the whole, again, the profile of the institution. So I actually headed the, I was coordinating the faculty selections as a deputy director of faculty at IIT Delhi. Entry level position selections, there was absolutely no lobbying. Nobody came. We had a selection at a higher level, associate professor or professor level, most of the time I'll be in my office till 9, 9:30 in the evening before the next day's selection, because some faculty members would like to come and talk about positive or negative contributions of the junior faculty who are now becoming senior faculty. But these are never the case when we are recruiting at the assistant professor level tomorrow.
I was always going back at my usual time of 7:30 p.m. because there absolutely nobody will come. And this essentially happened because we were completely stopped in bidding. Maybe we lost a few good PhDs in this process. It's possible. Maybe they went to other IITs. But the fact that senior professors were not competing to push their PhD students into the system helped a lot. Adopted, apply anytime. So this was considered to be something very important that everybody should apply against an advertisement. But we went, we said all year advertisement, open advertisement. And then we, of course, once travel became much more inexpensive, people could afford to travel and all these video conferencing processes came. So all of us adopted this visit anytime video conference selection. If you look at all these 4 points and you cut across all the IITs, all of them did it at different points in time. This is what I'm saying, the power of being able to collaborate and compete. How did they happen? We do not have an exact documentation on all these things, but you know, so this is a place where we exercised our autonomy and we exercised our flexibility. This is, I would consider to be a very good point. Faculty empowerment, the fact that we have fixed-term headship, that means we are no umpires. Even personal differences have a limited period impact. If you don't agree with the head, you can just wait a couple of years, things will change. There's a very positive thing that happened. No pyramidal structure. Many universities in India and abroad also, you know, unfortunately, we got it from UK, which was very hierarchical and people may retire as senior lecturers, even though they may be extremely good, but we didn't adopt it. People will get promoted basically based on their performance. Very positive step, which essentially meant that there are not too many frustrated people going around waiting for some people to retire. And in the last two and a half decades, we made a number of changes by empowering young faculty. Sole PhD supervision, sole PI for sponsored projects, initiation grants. Again, if you look at the, go around and look at all IITs, followed this path one after the other. So these are things which we've done right. So now I would like to talk a little bit about what I feel are some major changes that we need to do if we want to move from where we are to where we should like to be, you know, a globally eminent institution, which is part of the institution. Autonomy in DOG and director selection. IIMs have already have an agreement and seen it. I have had some discussions with some people involved. It's working well. They already have an experience of a few years. And the new net education policy actually reiterates this. So I would suggest that IIT Delhi, being one of the IOEs, we should immediately try to form a committee and go to the government with a proposal. How do we get autonomy in getting our BOG members and also the process of director selection, which is outside of it? We have to think financial sustainability. This is something which is extremely important. We got a breather. This 5 years of IOE funding, I would say, is a breather. And this funding will not last forever. And we need to think how do we, beyond this 5 years, how will we be financially sustainable. And this is not an easy job because this requires a mindset change for a lot of us. Has to be thought. And I think there is some low-hanging fruit in terms of M.Tech programs. If you look at the new education policy, because when they actually talk about M.Phil not being, so what is a very clear message is coming. Globally, people are moving towards bachelor's and PhD. And master's program are professional programs for training people who are in the industry. We should go into it. Executive MBAs are very well established and M.Techs are to go into that line. We spent so much effort in recruiting faculty. We made so many changes. We haven't made any change at all in recruiting our administrative offices. We need to invest and we need to completely overhaul because this type of investment is absolutely essential as the institution grows. These are three things. I'm not going to talk more about it. I'm going to talk a little bit more about three or four other things, which I think many of them we can do it in the within the institute. Some of them will require government support. Restructure Senate. Senate membership of professors by default is not neither sustainable nor desirable. We have 200 people today. We are going, we are talking of 10:1. We'll have 300 professors in 10 years, 420 years. This is not a decision-making body which can actually support an institution of this. Globally, it does not happen like this. Most of the professors have neither interest nor aptitude for academics beyond one's own field. They have interest in their field, but not beyond their own field. And just because by, you know, every faculty member would like to become a professor, but they have no really stake in becoming a Senate member. So I strongly suggest that we constitute a committee, and my suggestion is a 60-member Senate, half of it executive, half elected from different electoral colleges. This is a model that is being followed by many universities, and we should adopt it. We should have better representation of younger faculty based on interest. It is also our duty as an institution of eminence, as a national leadership, to build academic leaders for the institute and beyond. And a Senate membership is one particular place where you start showing an interest that you are interested in academics beyond your own area of work. Okay, so this is, so you know, create mechanisms and do that. And this will create a very vibrant Senate. The discussions will happen, which will be much more academic in nature. Rejuvenate departments. In two different roles as Deputy Director of Faculty, I have had 6 years of role in helping the director select the next head, visiting departments, taking inputs from them. But I must tell you, this is a place which requires a complete overhaul. The present process, the results of it is almost everywhere, the senior most professor becomes the next head. It's not very different from allotting type 2A members. But this is not a departmental leadership. So what I feel is what we can centrally do, there are constraints to it. We need to empower the departments by providing a leadership which will actually make a difference to the way the department thinks. Today, a good head is something who is just a facilitator. Somebody who is a good facilitator is considered a good head, but a good head has to be much more. We need a lot more dynamism. We need vision for the department. It should understand the trends. Yes, you know, she should understand the strengths and can manage change. Not every person is in a position to manage change. She has to have relationships, build relationships. 3 years may be too short to bring most changes. So I rarely see a head coming in with a vision of what is it that he majorly want to change in the department. Most of the heads would like to see, make sure that the department runs smoothly. That's an important thing. But if you want to reach global eminence, we need to make many major changes, and many more initiatives have to come from the ground up, and the heads are very important for doing that. And it's also our responsibility again to build academic leaders. And just like I said, Senate is one forum, headship is another forum to do that. UG admission. JEE has served extremely well, but JEE was successful in attracting talent and helping creating global visibility. Devang has talked about it. I would say there are two periods. 65 to 95 is a period when graduate students and faculty, we produce graduate students and faculty for top year schools. Students, aspirations of the students were primarily to go for higher studies, primarily to US, but also to other countries. They all went to, and the competition was the day they entered IIT, they were looking forward to graduating from here. So they were technically very, very focused, because their admission process depends upon how technically they perform within the institute. That was the first phase of IITs. Second phase is the success came through Silicon Valley and Wall Street. Very successful in entrepreneurship, especially for IIT Delhi. So our global visibility got built. And JEE was responsible for it in many ways. Not only we got talent, we also got a set of people who could focus themselves, because they focused themselves on writing this exam. They could work very hard, put in their efforts. But today, the JEE is actually losing talented graduates as applicants, I would say, at both ends of the socioeconomic spectrum. The high incomes, the traditional schools which actually supply students to IITs, today a large number of them are sending the students abroad, primarily because of the effort that is actually required to prepare income. Low income is constrained because of expensive coaching and uncertainty associated with it. You cannot afford to spend a lot of money with so much of uncertainty. So the people, it is still not a serious issue. It is still something, we still are getting extremely good students, but this will not last forever, especially if the new education policy brings in a lot more students into the, in a lot more educational institutions of higher quality into the country. Then your competition will increase and you will start losing at both ends much more. And this is a, and this is something I talked about also when I was here, and I will repeat it. No institution can maintain excellence if a significant number of its students are not interested in subjects they are enrolled for. We have to bring in a process of selection where aptitude matters. JEE can be helpful. JEE is still helpful, but it has run its life. The reason that it worked very well for the first 40 years of this institution is the top students are all focused on going abroad. So though Devang talked about brain drain, but the fact that the brain drain actually helped us in terms of keeping a technical focus on the ground, because this is where they could actually go. This is another point I think is extremely important. Promote research leaders. We have empowered faculty. Faculty today are able to create their small research groups. This is clearly that has happened. And we are whatever we are seeing benefits in terms of publications, research funding, all of that growth that we are seeing is essentially because of this empowerment. But we have no transparent process for facilitating research leaders to set up large research groups. I started my talk by dedicating this to Professor Indiresan. The fact that we could set up a center, which was called the School of Radar Studies at one time and then became Center for Applied Research, and could build. And if you look at it in the mid-70s, IIT Delhi, I would say the visibility in 80s and 90s happened because some of these professors, of course, the model that we adopted perhaps was not sustainable, the model needs to be relooked at. But there were people who were actually had vision, people who had the strength, people who could make the change, people bring together, they could think interdisciplinary, they could think systems. And these people were empowered by the institute to set up groups. And that is something we have to set up again, a transparent process for doing it. Create a transparent and accountable process for creating research centers led by faculty with leadership groups. Leadership is not something which we have to accept that it is not, cannot come by rotation. Leadership is something which people have to earn. People have to go beyond their own research to earn the leadership in an academic institution. We need to promote that. And this change by itself could actually change our visibility considerably. They adopt globally proven models for managing academic programs and research programs. It's not something, this is rocket science. It's not something we have to innovate. If you go to an institution, academic programs are run by the departments, research programs are run by the labs or by the research centers. A model that actually is compatible, we need to quickly move towards it, where we need to have these two set up so that people are empowered, people who can think big, people who can reach out, they are able to do that. So these are the thoughts I'd like to share. Thank you, and they're very happy. And I'm very grateful for this institute for all that it has done for me, and I think in a small way I've been able to give back to this. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Balakrishnan, for sharing your experiences and making some strong suggestions to bring in the required changes for the future. So thank you very much. I would now like to request Professor Saha to introduce the former directors, which are also our panelists for today's discussion.
Good afternoon, viewers. It's a happy occasion for me to introduce all the five directors of IIT Delhi under whom I worked as a faculty since 1996. Let me extend my heartiest welcome to all of them on behalf of the Diamond Jubilee Committee and thank them for accepting our invitation at a very short notice. First, let me introduce Professor V.S. Raju. He was a professor at IIT Madras and later became the director of IIT Delhi during 1995 to 2000. In a career spanning over four decades, Professor Raju had performed in many roles, like teaching, research, administration, industrial consultancy, etc. He coordinated major R&D projects on ocean energy. He was the lead partner in Vairaju Foundation, which adopted 155 villages in five districts of Andhra Pradesh. Professor V.S. Raju and his family have generously donated rupees 65 lakhs towards setting up a chair professorship at IIT Madras. I was recruited as assistant professor during his tenure, sir. You are welcome to this panel discussion.
Thank you very much.
Yes. Next, it is my privilege to introduce Professor Rajpal Singh Sirohi. He is an Indian optics physicist who was also a professor at IIT Madras. He became the director of IIT Madras due to Professor Sirsan Salaris and recipient of several awards, for example, Gabbard Award, IE, Award of ICO, and others. He was awarded with the fourth highest civilian award of the country. Padmasri in 2004 by the government of India. Welcome, sir, and sorry to trouble you in the middle of the night in the USA. Next is our senior colleague from the Department of Electrical Engineering at IIT Delhi, Mr. Surinder Prasad, who was our director during 2005 to 2011. Presently, he is an Usha Chair Professor and an Emeritus Professor at IIT Delhi. Mr. Prasad was awarded with the very prestigious Shanti Swarup Patnagar Prize for Science and Technology in 1988. Welcome you, sir, in this panel discussion. Next, Professor Raghunath Kashinath Shepgaonkar was a professor at IIT Bombay and became the director of IIT Delhi in 2011 till 2015. He was the Vice Chancellor of the University of Pune and presently the Vice Chancellor of Bennett University. Professor Shepgaonkar is a recipient of IEEE William Sale Award for Academic Leadership in 2013 and several others in the field of photonics and optoelectronics. Welcome, sir. Finally, the moderator of today's panel discussion and our present director since 2016, Professor Halippe Ramgopal Rao, was the PK Kelkar Chair Professor in the Department of Electrical Engineering at IIT Bombay. He was also awarded with the coveted Shanti Swarup Patnagar Prize in 2005 and several others, including the Swarna Jayanti Fellowship, Infosys Prize, and many more. Thank you, sir, for your leadership and make IIT Delhi as one of the first institutes of eminence in the country and agreeing to moderate this interesting session. Welcome, sir. Let me hand over to you, Professor Ramgopal Rao, to conduct the session.
Yeah, thank you, Professor Saha. I would like to thank Professor Raju, Professor Sirohi, Professor Surinder Prasad, and Professor Shepgaonkar for accepting our invitation to be with us. And between the four of them, they have shared almost one third of the last 60 years as heads of this institution. So 20 years of the 60 years, let's say. And also, if you are able to see further, it's all because we are standing on your shoulders. And that is what is helping us to see beyond anything else. And we also would like to thank you for shaping the institution during your time in a way where we can achieve so much more today. I will start with Professor Sirohi simply because he is in the US and he is at a very, it's a very odd time for him to be awake and to be speaking with us. So Professor Sirohi, I would like to start with you, and we would like to know, you know, from your point of view, how was your time? This is all about reminiscing your days at IIT Delhi. So some of your fond memories, what is that you missed about IIT Delhi after you left this institute, and what are your impressions about the past, present, and future of this institute, and anything interesting that comes to your mind, or anything that brings a smile, think of IIT Delhi. Professor Sirohi.
Thank you.
Professor Sirohi, you need to unmute.
Really very happy. I have not seen Professor Raju from last 20 years. So I'm not going to tell many things. I'm going to tell my story. And my story begins because I'm very strongly connected with IIT Delhi. I came to IIT Delhi in August 1964 as a student of post-MSc diploma in applied optics. And I got my diploma, in fact, completion of diploma in 1965. And since I was a topper of the class, I considered myself as the first student of IIT Delhi. Then I came again in August 1968 to pursue my PhD with Professor Sodha. I completed it within 2 years and then became an ad hoc lecturer in Department of Physics. I was there from June 1970 to February 1971 and then moved over to IIT Madras. Again, I came on December 13th, 2000 as director of because I have seen the IIT grow from the beginning, and when I came as a director, it was a wonderful institute. Now, I have many good or bad experiences. The first couple of weeks after joining are very critical. People try to measure the person, try to find how strong or weak he is, and so on. So in my first week of joining, I received two telephone calls from several, from very big persons. One was regarding unfinished work of Professor Raju, removal of Jhuggi Jhopri, that they should not be allowed to go out. And other one was regarding giving a compassionate employment service to one of the person in the institute. And I handled both of them. I did not agree. Then usually, you know, I would like to go walk through the campus. I noticed few things that near Jia Sarai, there used to be a lot of food plates lying around. There will be persons playing in the fields who had no connection with IIT. There will be people in the IIT library enjoying the summer because it was air conditioned. I thought there should be some ownership of IIT on its facilities. And what I found, there were 17 gates in the campus. In 1965, there was no boundary. But when I joined, there was a boundary. There were 17 gates, and I needed to close them, except the four and one opening. With the help of security officer, IIT security, we closed all the gates except four and one opening. There was a lot of pressure. And at this juncture, I would like to say that I received a lot of support from Professor Murali Manohar Joshi, who was then HRD minister. So we actually had a very safe campus now. Then in the first finance committee meeting, which took place somewhere in February 2001, my finance officer told me that there are 9 crore rupees which are to be taken forward. I said, what is this? He said, this money has to go and it will be in the next year's budget. I said, start distributing to the departments. And from then onwards, every year, whatever money was left, we were giving to the department. The result of this one was that some infrastructure was created, some research activities were created, and I placed a lot of emphasis on research. The result of this one was that in May 2005, in India Today ranking, IIT Delhi was number one. And when I joined in December 2000, it was at the lowest ranking. So I would like to thank all my colleagues, you know, who worked so hard to raise it to number one position. I was not there at that time because I left in April 2005. When I joined, regarding civil work, I must say something. When I joined, two buildings, one girls hostel, Himadri, and the other one was Vishwakarma building. They were under construction. I had to go to DST to get funds. So Professor Ramamurthy, who was the secretary DST, he helped me a lot. And we were able to get funds, and ultimately the Vishwakarma building came. But during my tenure, we had three big buildings, two boys' hostels and one Bharti building. And in fact, I did not want the Bharti building to be at a place where it stands today, but Rakesh Bharti Mittal was adamant to have it there. I wanted it to a place at a location from where Jhuggi Jhopris were removed. But since I knew that this was an open space, I wanted all the open spaces in the IIT campus to be planted with saplings. And this was the work which Professor Raju started, and I in fact carried it forward. We provided internet connectivity to all the hostel rooms and upgraded the hostel mess facilities. I would like to thank Professor Istiak, who carried out all this work. We also introduced or got the Board of Governors approval for the medical scheme for retired employees of the IIT. And that has, I am told, undergone a lot of changes, but the retired faculty was quite happy. I extended a lot of support to Alumni Association. And due to the involvement of Alumni Association, we were able to get first commitment of $5 million from Vinod Khosla, who wanted to start a school of IIT in honor of his parents. And we tried to strengthen the activities of Alumni Association. There were some unfortunate incidences also. There was one incidence of ragging which happened in the year 2003. I was attending a conference in Namibia, and my deputy director informed me that it's a very minor one, I need not worry. When I came, I saw a letter on my table written by the parent of the student who was ragged, and I realized that it is really a major incidence. Called the disciplinary committee meeting, and all the members of the disciplinary committee meeting told me that it was a minor issue. But then I used some kind of ingenuity and got it confessed in front of the disciplinary committee that it really ragging took place. The persons were penalized, and I think there was no incidence of ragging afterwards. We also, I encouraged this TBIUs. In fact, there were two TBIUs which were run by IIT student under the guidance of faculty members. One of them is Critical, which has really grown nicely. My contribution there was to provide support, financial support, in the form of scholarships to the student so that they can continue working on technology development without worrying about the finances. I had been number of times to SCST Commission. Sometimes I will have to accompany the secretary, HRD. I never had any difficult issues with him, with the chairman of SCST. The relationships were very cordial. I told him that we have to empower our SCST students, and that was probably implemented and practiced. I would like to give lot of credit to the people who manage JEE, JMAT, GATE examination. These are the people who are able to provide us the real talent to the IIT, and these are the people who have the highest degree of integrity. I respect them all. Then there was another issue which I took. When I joined, the number of students in IIT Delhi was 3,700, of that order. And I made some kind of calculations, and based on several factors, one of the factors was that IIT Delhi should be a fully residential institute. Keeping that in mind, I thought we can really raise the student strength up to 5,000 students. And slowly it was raised. When I left, it became 4,700. But later on, the government imposed, 50% increase in all IITs, and probably my decision was not a right one, or did not foresee what the government would like to do. There were issues with IBM Research Laboratory, which was located in IIT. Many of our professors wanted that to be moved out of IIT, but somehow other I managed to keep it during my tenure. I had the privilege to work with two chairmen. They had very different styles of functioning, but my relationship with both of them were cordial. I really do not recall any incidents where I had to face either hostile students or employees or faculty. It was a very cordial kind of environment. What I left unfinished, I almost was about to start 400 student girls hostel with single and triple occupancy. Blueprints were ready, the foundation stone could not be laid. I also wanted to have an academic building, very high-rise academic building along the Nala, which should be connected to the main building through an underpass, so that the space obtained by demolishing textile department and workshop, that becomes a green area and gives a much larger open space. That also I could not do. I also wanted to start 8 megawatt power station, gas-fired power station, because at that time the power would fail very often. Many of our labs were air-conditioned and they would not have power. So we decided to go for the power station. That also could not be completed, but it would be good that we have our power. My vision of IIT was to be one of the best institute in the world, not only academically, but in terms of infrastructure and appearance. And where is IIT Delhi today? Now, I see it only from the newspaper, that it stands 182 rank in the world ranking in 2020. We have 654 faculty members, 8,700 students, a very highly concentrated academic talent. And we have a space from 200, we can certainly bring down, from 182, we can certainly bring down this ranking. And we should be somewhere around 50 in next 5 years.
Yeah. Thank you, Professor Sirvi.
Can I take 2 more minutes?
Yeah, maybe. Yeah. Okay.
Okay. I would like to suggest that we should have a multi-story garage, so that there is a place where all the vehicles can be, and the security in the campus must be strengthened like it is in any of US universities. For me, IIT Delhi is a lovely place, a place where I grew, and I am indebted to IIT Delhi. I am very happy to be a part of this celebration, and thank you very much for the invite, and I wish good health to all my colleagues. Stay safe. Thank you, Professor Rao.
Thank you, Professor Saravi. Thank you very much.
And I will continue hearing others. I will go to sleep only after I have heard everybody.
Thank you very much. Thanks a lot. So now we move on. So in fact, Professor Saravi, whatever jobs were unfinished during your time were all completed subsequently by the other directors who are going to come online now. So Professor V.S. Raju, Professor Raju came from IIT Madras. So Professor Raju, would like to hear from you.
Yeah, thank you very much, Professor Rao, and my dear friends. Namaste to all of you, and a very good day. I am really delighted to participate in this function, because even though I left IIT Delhi 20 years back, it looks as if it was only very recently that I left IIT Delhi. First, I'd like to congratulate you, Professor Rao, and all your colleagues for sustaining and enhancing the excellence of the institution. It's a great, great achievement. You have the Institution of Excellence and many other rankings and many other contributions. I would like to share some of my experiences. First, I'd like to say it was a great privilege to be associated with IIT Delhi family. I would always call it IIT Delhi family. And I said I'm like the head of the family, so I have the responsibility to take care of everyone in the family. I received excellent cooperation from everybody, and it looks as if the 5.5 years went so fast, because we were happy there and also many things were happening. So the three key ingredients I found during my tenure was excellent cooperation and understanding, and many ideas that were given were accepted, discussed and accepted, and finally we reached a consensus and moved on. First, about the student strength. In 1995, I found that there were 2,400 students at IIT Delhi and 2,200 employees. Initially, as an young assistant professor, I used to feel very proud that we do very rigorous selections. But as I grew older, I started feeling the pain of so many bright youngsters losing opportunity to get good education. For example, I used to say, for a country of India's size, we need 50 IITs or 50 IIT-like institutions. So then I talked to my colleagues, and what can we do? We thought we should increase the student strength very drastically. I said, let us target to double the student strength in 5 years, from 2,400 to double that number. But I think what we achieved is in 5 years about 4,000. That is my memory. And I think it's quite substantial. And the staff strength came down to 1,100 from 2,200, because all retired employees, we closed down all workshops and no further recruitments. And all those spaces were used for academic activities. And naturally, when you increase the student strength, first you have to strengthen the academics. New faculty, of course, then you have to create extra space. To my surprise, I found when I visited all the laboratories that 20 to 30% of the lab space was clustered with obsolete equipment. And I said, why? They said, the write-off procedure is so complex. It takes years and we cannot write off this thing. So I found a quick solution by removing all of them and emptied the cement godown, and everything went to the godown, and then said that it takes its own procedure and process. Like that, we added the additional spaces in the buildings, additional spaces, additional floors on some of these buildings, and so on. But that also needed a lot of hostel accommodation, you know, because they're a residential campus. And so we had to speed up our construction processes. So I was able to get in L&T, Larsen & Toubro, to do the work on the campus. By normal procedures, thanks to my good friend who was the head of L&T, who was also an honorary visiting professor with us here, Ramakrishna, and also my association with L&T as a consultant. We got them at the lowest price bidding process, and things were built very fast. Then we said that we need also to work more closely with campus development. So, of course, IIT Delhi was very beautiful when I came in there, but I wanted to see more trees. Like Professor Siroi, I also grew up in IIT Madras for many years, so that's a much greener campus. That small vision, I told a small committee, I want to see 1,000 trees planted every year. They did 2,200 in first year, that's what they told me. Then we make it every year that norm, and I think 11,000 trees. The biggest bug for the campus, as I saw it, was a slum. I think there were 500 juggies, and then my estimate is 3,000 to 4,000 people not connected with the IIT at all or on the campus. And they were everywhere, on the lawns, playgrounds. You know, it was really, I come from a rural background, I have very soft corner of the poor people, but that is not the place for them to live on a campus like ours. So thanks to the Lieutenant Governor, with a lot of effort, we got an agreement to relocate the slum. And then they said IIT has to pay 1.6 crores for that relocation. That's quite a bit of money at that time because they are short of resources. But then when I mentioned this to Additional Secretary in the Ministry, he said, why should we pay for IIT Delhi's mistake? Then I went back to my office and I told the minister, please transfer 1.6 crores. So that happened, and then thanks to Professor Sirohi, the actual relocation took place after I left, and he stood firm from political pressure. That was very important. Then we also had to go for a lot of collaboration with industry. Then the IBM Research Center on campus, and that is the first research center of IBM to be set up in India. And then that was a wonderful initiative, I feel. And then, you know, it's interesting. We built that small building, which IBM was given, in 3 months. L&T built that building in 3 months. Then, of course, another important thing was we had the agreement with Sunil Mittal of Bharati Enterprises to have this Bharati School of Telecom Technology and Management. Mr. Mittal is an amazing person. I had a breakfast meeting with him requesting for 2 crores to start a business school on campus, and he wanted this Bharati school, and I said needs 20 crores. He said yes, can I give it over a period of time, and we signed it. Then you know, this Indian School of Business, which is now world class in the country, the seed of that Indian School of Business was laid on our campus. So I requested our alumnus Rajat Gupta to help us start a business school on our campus. So he called a meeting in our boardroom, a lot of industries came and discussed, and everything was more or less finalized. But he said, you know, these people, the faculty ought to be paid international salaries, and the student fee will be international. That is not possible. So I said, sorry, that cannot be done. So then he established it in Hyderabad, and he acknowledges that the seat for the ISB in India was laid at IIT Delhi. Then we looked for institution of chairs. We had Microsoft chair. We hosted a lecture by Microsoft chief, and then also some industrial chairs. Then, of course, there was a continuous interaction with the alumni. We had yearly get-togethers in the US and also on campus. Mr. Rajendra Pawar of NIT and his batch donated, the first donation, 60 hostel rooms they donated, because we were very short of money. Then also we had initial discussions with Vinod Gupta, then which resulted in his contribution of $5 million subsequently. Then there was also resource challenges, as I said, limited budgets. I'll take only one or two more minutes. Then we have taken various initiatives, tried to improve the consultancy and sponsored research, simplified procedures. And then, you know, what we, my wife and I, have enjoyed is also we had a lot of student functions, farewells, some faculty get together, all on director's lots. Always said, I never said it is my house. I always said it is your director's house. So then I think that was very, very enjoyable. I was just asking my wife yesterday, what do you remember most? This is what she remembered. On all festival days, we had girls coming over and spending time. Then, of course, we can go on and on, but we have a limited time. So the future, the basics are the same. Excellent faculty. Balakrishnan has nicely presented that. Completely agree with what he said, and then infrastructure, collaborations, flexibility, but also we have to adapt to changes. I think what was relevant 20 years back is probably not relevant today, and what is relevant today may not be relevant after 5 years. So I have no doubt under the our leadership, Professor Rao, and also the effort of all the faculty and the staff, IIT will grow to greater heights. Only on the international rankings, I am not too worried about it, because I think the lot of parameters which they take are not exactly. Once again, thank you for inviting me and giving me this opportunity. It's a great pleasure to participate in this function. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Raju. I think it's very interesting to, you know, see what all happened during your time. From that initiation of ISB on the campus to the compound wall and something very interesting kind of journey. So now I go on to Professor Surendra Prasad. So Professor Surendra Prasad comes from IIT Delhi itself. So Professor Prasad.
Thank you.
Muted.
Yeah. Inviting me to be part of this celebration. I distinctly remember 10 years ago, we were part of a similar exercise for our Golden Jubilee celebrations, and it brings those days to my memory. They were nice days. So I don't know. I don't know. Don't feel like making this, you know, CV reading exercise of what I did and did not accomplish during my tenure. But it is useful to hear what Professor Sirohi and Professor Raju have said. For me, I think I would first like to recall some of the challenges that I faced almost immediately or soon after I took up the position. The big ones for me were that the government suddenly decided to implement a 50% increase in student strength that was related to the OBC reservation issue. And this came on top of what Professor Sirohi and Professor Raju had already done in the previous 10 years. So for us, it became a really big, massive change. And we had to create, we had to first of all contain the student reaction, because it was linked to the OBC reservation issue. The students were not very happy about it, at least some students. And it created some reaction, which it took some effort to contain. But more importantly, it created unprecedented infrastructure challenges for us. Hostels, classroom sizes, and creating a diverse population in the classroom and handling the instruction of these mixed population. Now, this seemed to be quite a big task by itself. Certainly, very soon after that, we faced another challenge. The government decided to set up 8 additional IITs, absolutely from scratch. And IIT Delhi was to oversee the development of IIT Roper and make it run in less than a year's time. Adding to our own infrastructure limitations and preparations for their enhancement, this came as a huge additional responsibility. But I must thank my faculty, colleagues, and the people who helped me as deputy directors and deans, and many others who became, you know, who absolutely came to help and did everything that was possible to make sure that both these objectives were handled hand in hand. It is our own infrastructure development and things that had to be done at IIT Roorkee. So one is quick to learn that, at least in these times, director is really never above the society. We talk about academic autonomy and various other kinds of autonomies, that notwithstanding, you can influence a little here and there, but the major changes are always a result of evolving social dynamics. I think my previous two directors were lucky that they didn't have to face these kinds of social dynamics in their times. But then, I think these are things to be expected in a democracy like ours. But coming to some of the interesting things that happened, and which, as you said, bring a smile to one's face, are some of the things that happened almost by serendipity, or in some, I would say, something that was a contribution of a large number of people. I won't like to claim any personal credit for any of these things. The first thing that, you know, one of the earliest things that we did was to think of setting up a school of biological sciences, because first of all, it was a natural movement beyond the Department of Biochemical Engineering we had famed for over the years. But given that the next century, that is 21st century, was to become primarily centered around the important discipline of biosciences, that became the basis of this decision. Almost all faculty members were in favor of setting up such a school, although there were big apprehensions about how to go about it, because there were issues about how to find space for it, of how to seed it with the right faculty, and of course the realization that such facilities need enormous funds. Setting up clean labs, you know, of the highest order, safe biosafe labs, very expensive things. So we were apprehensive about it. But many of these problems got resolved more easily than we thought it could be possible. It so happened, you know, both Professor Raju and Professor Sirohi talked about the IBM India Research Labs, which was located in the campus. At this very time, they decided to move into their own facility in Vasant Kunj. That was a godsend for us. I mean, it was nice to have them on the campus, but we needed the space ourselves at that time. So that resolved the space issue for us. Faculty seating happened through our efforts of finding the right people from various places, both senior and junior. But one of our alumni, I think it was Mr. Dikshit, who came up with a proposal of 25 crores to support this initiative. And then we put some resources of our own. Some came from DBT. And I think we were quite comfortable in setting up the biosciences school. And that's very gratifying to see that the school is coming up well. And I was happy to hear you say enormous contribution they are making to the COVID-19 pandemic, besides contributing to basic research in the area. Continuing on such stories, I recall in one of the early board meetings that we had, you know, we had a young MP from Haryana, Devinder Hooda ji, and we got talking about our campus and about our facilities. And I mentioned to him that I see limitations in the future growth of the institution because of this being a very small campus. You know, I was familiar with the IIT Kharagpur campus, which is so big. IIT Kanpur and IIT Bombay were bigger than IIT Delhi campuses, much bigger, in fact. And I also requested him if he could help us with some space not too far away from IIT. That was a difficult proposal for him to consider, but he said he will look into it. He was very enthusiastic about looking into this issue. and a few phone calls later, some meetings later, some site visits later, some sites were identified both in Sonipat and Jhajjar. So although the actual transfer of land happened after my term was over, I think the groundwork that was done during my time, during that time, was really helpful at that time. I think we are just lucky there. I don't want to claim any personal credit for it, because it was, you know, just serendipity that made these things happen. And I realized after looking at some accounting issues, you know, particularly with respect to IRD accounts, that we were sitting on a huge resource of funds which were not being utilized at all. These funds got accumulated as a result of interest that we received from, let's say, banks where we used to keep this money, basically from the IRD projects that we had. And ideally, these funds should have been returned to the sponsoring organizations. All the interest has to be returned to the sponsoring organization. But somehow that never happened. So this situation we corrected for the future times. But then we thought to ourselves how to return this money to all the sponsors who helped us in the past. And that seemed to be almost an impossible task. So we went to our board and requested that we be allowed to use these funds as a research purpose. And that was a considerable sum of money. I don't remember the exact magnitude, but nearing almost 100 crores or perhaps even more. And this became a source of providing for new research facilities and significant scaling up of our research capacity. And I think we set up some institute chair positions also based on these funds. Anyway, we use this in a number of high impact research ideas that our faculty members had at that time. The small other few small things that occur to me are the fact that we never celebrated a foundation day. In fact, institute faculty and students had no idea of the foundational history of IIT Delhi. So we corrected that situation and we started celebrating the foundation day. I still vaguely remember the first lecture that Shri Gopal Krishna Gandhiji gave on this occasion. Very hilarious and thought-provoking lecture. And I think it has since become a tradition to have a foundation day lecture of some kind or the other. So that was nice. I guess I will probably leave it at that with one thought for the future. I think we need to continue to ask ourselves why we exist as an educational institution. And the obvious answer is to prepare the future generations of men and women who will make a difference to life in this world. I think that requires that we continue to impart them good knowledge and also help development of wisdom. Now, IITs have traditionally managed to fulfill both these objectives through excellent classroom instruction and providing an excellent environment outside the classroom for their personality and wisdom development. I think with the increase in student strength that we have seen in the recent past, both of these objectives are already becoming a big challenge, at least in my perception. Because teaching a mixed class is a very different kind of objective than teaching a class of highly brilliant, more or less focused students who will readily understand whatever the teacher is talking about. Similarly, providing an environment outside the institute for a proper development of their personality and wisdom is going to be more challenging in the days to come. So I think the present generation of faculty leadership has a very important job to do, and they should apply their minds as to how this issue should be sustained in the future. I have no doubt that the rankings will improve as they have been doing all these years. But I think in the days to come, unless we tackle this issue of education to a mixed population and to a much larger student population, I think we'll have some problems if we don't look at this seriously. But thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. It is a pleasure to talk about a few of these things to all of you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Surendra Prasad. I think I'm sure I can imagine what life must have been with the Mandal Commission and 50% increase in the student intake. But I think that bringing biology into IIT Delhi, I think was such a good decision. We are now seeing the impact of that in so many different ways. Also, these extinction campuses that got initiated during time are really becoming very useful now in our expansion plans. I think these are great initiatives indeed. Now we come to Professor Shugankar. Usually, every director thinks that the previous directors had an easy time. I don't want to say that when it comes to Professor Shugankar. Professor Shugankar, we want to hear, Professor.
So, good afternoon. Thank you very much, Professor Rao, for inviting the Diamond Jubilee celebration. Thanks to Professor Saha, Professor Bua, who got in touch for coming and talking about my interaction with IIT Delhi when I was the director. So first of all, let me tell you that I came to IIT Delhi not really by design. Not even I had planned for coming to IIT Delhi. I was in IIT Bombay, as you all know, all through. And then when the IIT Delhi selection was taking place, I had applied for that, director sent my application. But on that particular day when the interview was getting held, I had to attend a very important marriage. And on the previous day, somebody called me and said, so today, tomorrow you are having an interview. So all my best wishes. And I said, yeah, but I'm not going for the interview because I'm going for a marriage. And then he said, no, don't do that mistake. You know, you should go for the interview. You should never drop an interview like that. It's a very important interview. And it so happened that I came and appeared for this interview. And I was selected. People may not know that this was probably one of the selection committees when right after the interview was done, it was declared that you are selected for the position. And so that's how actually I got came to IIT Delhi. Now, I have seen IITs, I have seen state universities also, and now I am seeing private university also. And I must say that we should be really happy and privileged to be associated with IITs. In fact, after seeing this variety of institutions, we come to realize how good our institutions are, how important IITs are, how privileged we are to be associated with this institution, and how good thing we can do, transformation we can do into the society. Now, after coming to IITs, as any person who comes from outside, then he starts seeing some small gaps here and there in functioning. And the same thing happened to me also. And the gaps, if you don't address within a year's time, then you become part of the system, then you stop seeing those gaps and you know things become almost like status quo. But the first thing which I realized when I came to IIT Delhi was that there was some need for more decentralization. There were a lot of things which were really centered towards the director. And many of the things, even the routine things used to come for signature or approval for a director. So my first question was at that time, do you require any discretion on this from me? If it is a routine thing, probably it doesn't have to come to me. If it is a discretion required, then you come to me, otherwise you don't have to come. So that was something which I had to do immediately as soon as I took the charge. The second thing which I realized was that the structure which was there in IIT Delhi, and for that matter in other IITs also it so happens, that everybody is busy in addressing the day-to-day jobs. And people don't have much time to really think futuristic because they are too occupied into day-to-day jobs. So I realized that maybe there has to be one person who really look into this and try to think futuristically. And that's how actually this new position of Deputy Director Strategy and Planning was created. Earlier, this was for the faculty, Deputy Director Faculty, which Bala was there. And then we changed it to Strategy and Planning. And then Bala continued for a while, and then Professor Sivankal took that position. But then that position actually created some thinking for the futuristic direction. And then many things started happening for the futuristic planning, design, and so on and so on. Well, many things happened during my period. And one of the most challenging time which I had was when the JEE pattern was changing. the government, the HRD wanted to push certain pattern of our JEE. They wanted to include the 12th March also for the selection into IITs. And then IIT Senate was very strong in saying that this is the prerogative of the Senate and we should decide what the admission criteria should be, and the government has no role to play on this. And I still remember very distinctly that we had a Senate meeting, and in the Senate meeting, it was unanimously decided by the IIT Delhi Senate that we will overrule the recommendations made by the government and we will go by the admissions criteria which is decided by IIT. And I said, yes, even if I am getting directions from HRD, I will stand for the Senate and I will communicate this decision of Senate to the government. And we did that, and I'm very happy that actually when the school faculty and the Senate really stands very strong, the government also bends down, they accept, and finally that advanced JEE concept was accepted and the 12th March became only qualifying examination and so on and so on. So that was one of the most challenging points. Second thing which I, when I came to IIT Delhi, which was a very pleasant thing for me, was that I never came to IIT Delhi before I became director of IIT Delhi. Only once I came on my LTC and I stayed into that guest house for a while, few days. Other than that, I did not really have a good feel for the institution. The whole structure of IIT Delhi, the gardens, the lawns, they are so well manicured. That when you enter IIT Delhi campus, you feel as if you are entering into a garden. And that was a significant change from IIT Bombay, which also is very, very green. But IIT Bombay is very wild green. Whereas IIT Delhi, when you look at it, you see really the rose gardens and, you know, multicolored flowers. So that was a very, very pleasant experience. Staying in director's bungalow in IIT Delhi is an experience in itself. I think this was one of the best bungalows you can ever live in. I think Professor Dogra designed that, people told me, and I think it was a fantastic bungalow I lived in. During my tenure, many good things happened. I think Professor Rao put this point, what brings a smile on your face? I would say the list is really very, very long, in my opinion. I should not take really credit for this whole thing. It so happens that this is a matter of space and time. You have to be at the right time, at right space, and that's what happened during my tenure. The first thing is IIT Delhi was ranked number one institution in QS ranking. That was one thing which was very, very heartening to see. At the same time, we had a review committee which came to IIT Delhi, which was chaired by Professor Goel. And there were people like, from Stanford, and there were people from US. All the people came and visited IIT Delhi, and they were highly appreciative of the entire functioning of IIT Delhi and the achievements of IIT Delhi. So that was another thing which brought the smile on the face. The third thing, which Professor Surendra Prasad already mentioned, is getting this land, extra land for IIT Delhi Extension Campus. I think Professor Surendra Prasad started that, and I had to follow it with Mr. Huda, and finally we got this land in Sonipat and in Jhajjar. Getting a land is one part, but people who were present that time for the inauguration of this land, they would remember what an exciting event that was. That event was not only IIT Delhi event, it became more like a political rally. In fact, IIT Delhi people were almost pushed aside into the entire event, because there were three or four buses came full of people. There was a minute-to-minute program which was sent to IIT Delhi for the inauguration, which started at 10 o'clock in the morning and had to finish by 11 o'clock. But believe me, this program started at 1 o'clock in the afternoon and actually ended at 8 o'clock in the evening. That was minute-to-minute program followed by the government, by the people who gave us the land. So that was the most exciting event. But finally, we got the land, and I see now the extension center has been set up there. Another thing which happened was the supercomputing facility, which was set up at IIT Delhi. 1 megawatt solar plant was set up at IIT Delhi. Now you see all the solar panels on this on the wing above the wings. Another exciting thing happened is that IIT Delhi, anybody visitor who came to Delhi, even the very, very VIPs, they had a wish to come and visit IIT Delhi. And that was something very heartening. For example, John Kerry, when he came to see IIT Delhi, apparently he had some 1 hour free time in between. And his secretary asked him, what would he like to do in that 1 hour? Would he like to see any monument in Delhi? And he said, no, he would like to visit IIT Delhi. So within a very short notice, previous evening we got a message that next morning the Secretary of State is going to visit IIT Delhi. Same way the Stephen Chu came and he gave a lecture. It was a lecture, he had only 1 hour during lunchtime, and the lecture was arranged. It was about the energy, and that time Stephen Chu was the Secretary of State in the United States. So these are something very exciting things which really happened. And the contribution is not only of the director, but the contribution actually came from all the DDs, all the deans, the entire faculty. And all put together, I think, kept this whole spirit of making this IIT Delhi as an institution of eminence, which finally culminated into, and today you are having the institution of eminence. The challenging thing which I found during this time was getting really the faculty strength maintained in IIT Delhi. And the reason is simple. The first generation people started retiring. We conducted interviews, very regular interview. Every year we could recruit at most 50 people at the quality faculty, and 25 faculty would almost retire. So the net gain of faculty was only 25, and when there was a vacancy of faculty of almost 400 to 500. So it looked almost like an impossible task to really meet that ratio. Whatever faculty you have to recruit, you have to run for next 10 years. I'm sure the exercise must be going on even now. So that was one of the challenges which we had. Another challenge which was there was, and I think this is true for IIT Delhi, I think we are too close to power center. And being close to power center has certain advantages, but at the same time, there are certain disadvantages also. I think it is like a planet can survive not close to the sun, not too far away from the sun. I think the IIT Delhi is in the same situation. So what happens many times, many internal small petty things also get reported to MHRD for no reason. And MHRD also start looking into internal affairs of the institution, which is not really required. So today when the national education policy is talking about autonomy, I hope that this micromanagement of the institution because of the proximity in Delhi, for IIT Delhi, it will stop. And IIT Delhi will start functioning really independently the way they want to function. I think Bala mentioned that, and I think that's very, very important. Some future direction, and which I always thought and used to say in IIT Delhi also, we have to create more multidisciplinary culture. And for that, our humanities and social science department has to get strengthened. I think liberal arts program have to become rich. They should start playing more and more role into engineering. And I think national education policy also emphasizes that. And I think IIT will really do that. Next thing which IIT Delhi can do is that NEP again emphasizes for creation of the educational leaders. You may not believe it, but there is really acute shortage of educational leaders, not only within IIT system, but if you just go outside IIT system, you will see that there is an acute shortage of the leaders. Can IITs play a major role in creating educational leaders who will go out of IIT system and create the culture similar to IITs in those institutions so that they can also come on par with what the IITs are really doing. Third thing which is I think we have to strengthen is we should connect more with the society. I think still IITs are not as much connected with the society as they need to be. And they still are considered to be elite institution, and common man still feels it is beyond their reach. I think IITs should get connected with the society by solving the local problems of the society. And finally, I would say that the industrial connect, I think everybody has been talking about industrial connect. I also try to do something, but I think a strong linkage from the industry and getting from the industrial funding for doing research, which industry can make use of and monetize it. I think still there is a long way to go in that direction. I think Professor Rao has experience in entrepreneurship, setting up businesses. He also has industry connects. So I think with this, there will be more strength which will be created, and you will have a strong partnership. So with this, I would express my best wishes to the institutions. I think 60 years Diamond Jubilee is a landmark, and I think IIT Delhi has done excellently well on this, and in the years to come, I'm sure it will do much, much, much better. So my best wishes to everybody, and thank you very much, Professor Rao, again for the invitation. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
The administrative reforms that you initiated, now I think are all on track, and a lot of decentralization is happening that way. And also the sun example you gave is very appropriate. The temperatures were very high earlier. I think they have cooled down a little bit now. So I think that way things are looking better, I would say. And of course, you know, as we all know, Rome is not built in a day. I think the contributions of all of you have really helped the Institute to reach whatever it is today. The fact that we have got the Institution of Eminence in the first lot of three institutions, you know, is all because of efforts of so many people, the alumni, the faculty, the previous directors, the staff, everybody has done their bit. I think that is why we are where we are today. And we are also able to see far because, you know, we are standing on all your shoulders. And Institute also remembers with gratitude all your contributions. I keep hearing your names almost every day from somebody or the other for the great things that you have all done. And I think Institute has a lot of depth. I think even for me, coming from IIT Bombay, I did not know much about IIT Delhi. But I have realized in the last 4 years that there is a lot of depth in the Institute when it comes to research. And that is also showing up in the world rankings when it comes to research impact and all of that. And also, IIT Delhi takes its academics very seriously. In fact, sometimes very, very seriously. So in the COVID kind of times now, to relax anything, I can tell you is a very big and a major change, because the focus on academics, the focus on examinations, focus on maintaining certain standards when it comes to teaching, learning. I think these are the ethos of the Institute, and we're all, you know, trying to retain these and as we move ahead. And I'm sure IIT Delhi has a great future, will reach greater heights. And I'm definitely, you know, I'm very confident in a way that it will reach its the rightful spot in terms of the global eminence and all of that. I think we are on track. Everything is looking fine. So thank you very much. Thanks to all of you. In the interest of time, we need to close. Otherwise, we can go on and on. There are so many interesting things to learn from you. Thank you very much, Professor Raju, Professor Sirohi, Professor Surendra Prasad, and Professor Shubhankar. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Rao.
Thank you, Professor.
Thank you, Professor Thakkar. Thanks for staying for all these sessions.
Yes. Very, very interesting to hear all senior colleagues talk about the alma mater.
Mm. Okay. So, on behalf of faculty, staff, and students of IIT Delhi, on behalf of Professor Ram Gopal Rao, Director of IIT Delhi, and the entire Golden Jubilee Celebrations Committee, it's my pleasure to thank our distinguished speakers, Professor Thakkar and Professor Balakrishnan, for accepting our invitation and sharing your thoughts and experiences. It's also a matter of immense pleasure and happiness to have the former directors of IIT Delhi here in this function to listen to their memories, experiences, and challenges that they face. Thank you very much, Professor Raju, Professor Sirohi, Professor Sundar Prasad, and Professor Shivgaonkar for accepting our invitations and, you know, being a part of this exciting panel discussion. In particular, we thank Professor Sirohi being awake you know, while it's midnight, past midnight in the US. And I thank Professor Ram Gopal Rao for leading this discussion. I also thank Professor Ram Gopal Rao, Professor Kanpal, who is the Deputy Director of Operations, Professor Ganguly, Deputy Director of Strategy and Planning, for their strong support in planning and execution of this event. And I hope we continue getting that support for entire next year as we move forward. I also thank the team members of the Diamond Jubilee Celebrations Committee, which includes staff, students, and faculty representatives, for their hard work, different teams of IIT Delhi who have contributed to the successful organization of this event. And finally, I thank all of the faculty colleagues, staff, students, alumni, well-wishers, and friends of IIT Delhi who are watching this event live, and, you know, viewers all around the world for joining this program. Thank you very much.
Also, thank you, Professor Bala, for your excellent presentation. Very nice.
Thank you. So, with this, we are at the end of this section two, and we would close with this thanks note. Thank you.
Thank you.
A participant has left the meeting.
Done.